and we're live! I screwed that up. Hello all! Wait, no. And we're live? 3, 2, 1. And we're live! Hello all, and welcome back to the Invictus stream. My name, as always, is Mr. Harlan Guthrie, and the man to the, with the hand right here is my buddy, Justin. Say hello, Justin. We got the very sexual Chris Visu.
Hello.
And we got Jabba the Michael lounging back in a chair. And we are here with game one of The Strange, part four. Thank you all for being here with us on this lowly Wednesday night. We are so excited. I've been looking forward to this all week to spend time with my friends and my friends. Thank you guys for being here. Chris, how are you feeling? You're eating.
Sorry. I'm feeling great. Hey, I'm feeling well fed.
Don't apologize for being you. Don't ever.
I'm really good, Harlan. Thank you. Thank you for asking. I'm having a good time so far, and I'm looking forward to tonight. And I think I'm going to win it. It's going to be a good game. Good game.
Good. Good. Side note, I always thought you'd be a really good hunter. And my favorite of the twins are the Olsons. I got to say, I think personally, out of all the twins, Olson are my favorites. But and you would be a great hunter, Olson.
You think so?
Hunters.
Yeah, something about Hunter and those Olsen twins. So we are here with The Strange, Game 1, Part 4. We're going to do another round of applause because I'm excited. We're almost at the halfway point. What's that?
I was going to say, have you seen that movie with the other Olsen sister where it's this old boy who's hunting? He's like a hunter for the person who put him in prison.
That's right.
Hunter, and there's the Olsen sister who's in there.
That's right, and they're hunting Olsen, and I remember that. Interesting. That's very crazy. I gotta say, I like her almost more than the other Olsen, but not
Hunter Olsen. Hunter Olsen. Hunter Olsen. Hunter Olsen. Hunter Olsen.
This might be an 18-plus show, so be weary. And I do want to mention that tonight...
It's because of my pelvic thrust tonight.
Yeah, there's going to be a lot of pelvic thrust tonight, as you can see here. There's also the... We're running the risk of this being... Yeah, that's right, I'm taking off my sweater, ladies and gentlemen. This is going to be an 18-plus show now. Tonight's episode might be a little, shall we say, risque. So if you feel like you are easily offended, we understand. You can turn away. But we like to push the boundaries here on the Invictus stream. We like to go at it. We like to push the fizz, as Justin says.
Push the fizz, man.
I'm more like this.
We them boys, we them boys, we them boys. Don't do it. Don't hit me.
So it's going to get a little risque up in here, but we're going to have fun doing it, and we want you to be here with us. So don't go anywhere, and if you get scared, just hug Michael. Please, if you're watching this on YouTube, go ahead and like it on YouTube. If you're not watching on YouTube, I don't know how the hell you're watching it, but go to YouTube anyway and like it because it makes us feel special. We just reached our 1,000th subscriber on YouTube. I get it. Look, guys, we know it's not the top of the mountain, but you know what? 1,000 of us is worth celebrating. So we popped that champagne, we Skyped each other, we started doing things that made us feel really good and
rolling diets.
Yeah, getting the shake weights and stuff like that.
Yeah.
One of us even brought a baby to Jabba's palace. So that's how excited we are about 1,000. Thank you guys so much for being so cool and being here with us because it makes it all worth it. All those slavery hours. So if you're watching this on YouTube, like it on YouTube. If you're a tweeter, go ahead and tweet us and follow us on Twitter because we like that. And also, and most importantly, join our Facebook group. When you join our Facebook group, you get to be a part of everything. Just everything. The world is yours. You get to be a part of the community and talking with these people. You might get a chance to win most valuable post, which means your post was the most informative, it created the most discussion, it was the coolest, you took pictures of us, any of that usually wins. But this week, I want to announce the winner it was based on a very good question, actually, that prompted a lot of discussion, made us very happy. So, the most valuable post for this week is our very own Howard Renardo. Although I think it's French, it would be Renardo. As they chuckle at me. For his post, does anyone have tips or hints for a novice GM on making things go smoothly? Guys, this is exactly why we have the community, to ask these questions. And I've had a lot of people message me privately and been like, hey, I have a question. Can I post it? Of course. Or they ask me directly, hey, what would you do in this situation? All that kind of stuff is perfect for the community. We have 225 people and we're growing, and that's exactly why we want to do that. We want to make sure everyone's happy and doing all that kind of stuff. So that's the place to ask it. So well done, Howard. You asked a fantastic question. It comes with a lot of discussion. You win Most Valuable Player, which is actually Most Valuable Post. I drank a lot before starting this. This is going to be a crazy game. The other thing you can do by joining the Facebook group, and the other thing you get, is you can submit ideas for the cipher. The ciphers are your suggestions for the most creative content and how these guys can then use it in-game. You should all know what ciphers are, and I don't really want to explain it. So this week we had the post, and I think Chris picked the theme. Chris, do you remember what theme you picked first off?
Yeah, and I regretted it almost immediately because it's so specific to where we ended up, and I had no idea where we're ending up. So I'm hoping at some point we get to face zombies, because the theme was, if you were trapped on a desert island and you were being attacked by zombies, what weapon would you bring? And everybody's post was so specific to the zombie. I just meant weapon. I should have just said weapon, but I said zombies, and now unless we face zombies, we're really screwed.
That's right. And these guys don't know who they're facing. And that being said, before I read these, I will say that to these guys and to you guys, we have a surprise for tonight's game. It's going to be a heck of a time. A little bit of a wild card, so to speak. But he's right. That was the really specific, and I think I even kind of based it down to just weapon zombie on a desert island. I don't know why the desert island was important, but it added either way. So we have the votes are in, and I'm going to read the top three winners as of right now for the Cypher Creative Contest. Number one is our very own Keelan Crowe. For his little gadget, the Talking Dead. The Talking Dead. Keelan, you are going to be featured in the game. Cypher is, not you, unless you want to just give us a face and we can glue it on the cypher.
Well, he put his heart and soul into this one, so I think he feels he'll be...
It's physical heart and soul.
Huh.
That's what we want to... it's got to be tangible. But the Talking Dead is a dried-out ear belonging to the now-deceased school teacher and polyglot Miss Rosetta Stone, having always shown a natural flair for picking up languages. Oh, it's really long. And because I put it in Excel, it does that weird thing that just shifts everything, and I can't even read what I wrote. So, unfortunately, we don't get to know exactly what it does, but we will use it in game, so we're going to find out. Well done, Keelan. You won first place with 4 votes. Technically, a landslide victory over second place. Jose A. Ramirez Ruiz. For Danny Trejo's Machete of Doom, the Collector's Edition. Something that, while I have no idea what it is, I want it because I love Collector's Editions, as you can see. Well, I got a Pip-Boy here, but you can't see it. But I like that kind of stuff. So well done, Jose. You got second place. And third place is actually a tie with pretty much everybody that got one vote, which is John Buey. I don't know how to say your last name. I'm sorry. Jason Jordan, Peter Stoffels, and Bob Lyle. So you four all have a chance to win third place. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to roll a 1d4. And in the order that they appear to me, John, Jason, Peter, and Bob, that is... Oh, sorry, and Christopher. My apologies. So that's actually 5. That's more confusing now. So we're going to go Christopher, John, Jason, Peter, and Bob. And I'm going to roll a d6, and on a 6 I'll just roll again. So here we go. Who's going to win them? We got number 6, so we're going to roll again. This is like our rolling for everything. Okay, 5. Bob Lyle, you have won, my friend. With my favorite title, the Dick Puncher 6900, I guess it would be. So well done, Bob. You won third place. And thank you to everybody who's submitting the ciphers. Everyone who enters gets 1 XP. First place gets 4, second place gets 3, third place gets 2 XP, and everything that entered gets 1. So please, if you have an idea, even if you think it's half-baked, go ahead and submit it, because it's always fun to read all of them. And while it doesn't seem like I do, I have. It's just because there's 14 entries per week that I keep forgetting which ones are which. But they're all hilarious. They're all fantastic. And you guys are so great at creating that content. So please keep it up and just give yourselves a round of applause for doing such great work. This is participation ribbon time, guys. This is the good stuff. So, that is what we have. Like I said, we are on part four. Tonight's game might be a little mature. Please join and like us on, join on Facebook and like us on Facebook. MVP was Howard, and the Cypher winner, the top spot, was to Keelan. That's all of my forefront bullshit. Are you guys ready to play?
I think, before we play, it wouldn't be bad for you to mention at least one more time about Pruny's Pub, because that's new.
That's right! I forgot. So last week, right after the game, we launched Pruny's Pub, which is a part of the Discord app. And Discord is still in its alpha stages. It's kind of like Skype, but allows for text chat in a little more comprehensive way, as well as audio chat. We've launched that server. It's actually in the sidebar of our Facebook group. And what it is you can go on and role play while you're working or after work or in bed at night. You can get it on your phone. You can get it as a desktop app. You can get it in a browser. And basically what you can do is you can walk into Pruny's Pub in a character of your own making, your favorite character maybe that you've ever played in D&D or in any other game, as long as it's in a fantasy setting, and you can talk to people. You don't have to do anything other than that. Just talk in and have a little bit of a role-playing dialogue. Work on your character creation. Work on, you know, what you think makes really great dialogue. And you can even use, you know, ideas that you might get in there for your own games. But if you want to take it beyond that, you can talk to people in the pub, and some of them will be offering quests. And I know I ran one with Jose and Kelsey, and it was last week after we launched it, the next day. And it was just a little mission that I sent them off into the woods, and they had to battle a greed demon, and it was fantastic. It was a lot of fun. So it's really as much or as little as you guys want to put into it, but it's a role-playing server. If you want to run a game, something very simple, something very straightforward, there are little sub-rooms that you can meet in. You can go into back room 1, 2, or 3, and you can say in the pub, you know, meet me in back room 1. I need someone to do a small mission. And a few people might come in there, and they might be too many. You can ask them to leave politely, or the right number might come in. You say, look, guys, in character, of course, I need you guys to go down the road and slaughter a few chickens to get back at, you know, the farmer that stole some of my hay. Ignorant farmers. I don't know. They'll screw it up. That's the exciting missions. Okay, let me just say that. It's on the cusp. Anyway, so then the people can say, okay, let's do this. And you can then send them to Forest 1 or Forest 2 or whatever setting you want to. You meet them there and continue the story. And again, it's just an opportunity to role play where you can do some fair role playing. Dice rolls are not really needed if you're doing fair role playing. And actually, Jose asked a great question like this on the community page this week about, you know, do you really need a lot of rule system? And a lot of time, if you're being a really fair GM or a fair player, the rule system can come second. I mean, it does add that level of chance, which is always great. But really, the whole point is that you're telling a story, an interactive story that interests people. So that's what Discord is.
Yeah, so if you got, you know, droned out by Harlan's beautiful voice, it's Discord at Pruny's Pub at the Discord, right?
Yes, it's on the sidebar of the of Facebook, so you can find it right there and link to it. Otherwise, you can go to Discord and just search the Invictus stream. So hopefully my voice wasn't droning you out. But that is basically what it is. And he asked.
No, it was good.
I just wanted to make sure people know. Anyway, that's all for me. I'm done talking for the night. Now let me slip out of my, you know, stuff, grab the book. Oh, where did I put the book? Oh, no.
Go get it. We'll wait.
No.
We'll vamp.
We don't need it. We'll just do this. All right, Justin. As is tradition, I'm going to get you to do the theme song, but just because we want to stay current, give me the music to enter The Strange, Episode 4.
Tiptoe through the tulips by the window. La da 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 da.
Look at those special effects.
Ta-da.
As our three intrepid explorers, adventurers, travel to the strange, a single thought crossed through each of their minds. But Dr. Dex Dalton, he thought of how this world was totally like a video game and how he probably would have leveled up by now.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
The sly Fitzgerald, the fear of not seeing his wife again trickled through his mind. However, love, passion, and the drive to move forward allowed him to force the thought out of his head for the time being. For Liam, he questioned when the last time he had pooped. He didn't recall pooping before he died. He surely didn't poop while traveling in the woods. Did he even have to poop now? When they landed, they saw their translation object, the Holy Grail, laying behind a plexiglass case, a display case of sorts. Beside it, a myriad of other odd trinkets and doodads that littered a large museum-like room, each in their own plexiglass case. For a moment, with a confused look, they turned to each other. And as they gained their composure, they noticed three very odd things. The first being the large window, which brought a high vantage point to the sprawling city of New York. But not exactly as it had been. A half-finished skyline, with incomplete towers, warships on the water, and a large blimp with a pretty little black windmill painted upon a red background on the side, filled the landscape. The second thing they noticed was the thin red armband on each of them, on their bicep, displaying the same pretty little black windmill that lay on the side of the blimp outside. And finally, the third thing was the distinct clicking of shoes along the marble corridor just outside the large room that suddenly transpired into a fully uniformed man turning the corner and entering the room. With a frail wave of his hand and a half-hearted Heil Hitler, the German solidified our hero's suspicions that first appeared after seeing the giant swastika on the blimp outside. They were, in fact, in Nazi-occupied New York City. Chapter 4. I did not see that coming.
Something's different.
Didn't the guy just acknowledge us? Don't we have to say it back?
The gentleman gives you a curt nod and exits the room. However, the narrator was not done talking. And before you can even take a second to breathe, a large flash enters the room and a creature stands beside you.
No, shit!
He's here.
The gentleman that stands beside you gives you a curt nod and looks at you with a devious smile.
And I give him a curt nod. And then I give Sly a curt nod.
And I give Dex a curt nod back.
Liam a curt nod.
The nod I give to Liam's a little longer.
Oh. And then I give Sly a look. What gives? Why didn't you nod to me as long?
And then I think to myself, you know what you did, and I give him the eyes that say that.
Oh, wait. And then I turn back to this new guy, and I nod to him again.
And then I go, wait, wasn't there only three of us when we left the witches? Sir, who are you? And I walk over to him. Is he dressed, and does he have a band around his arm?
He is dressed similarly to yourselves, yes.
I'm just enjoying the art here in this museum. It's hot here, eh?
Yeah, and I don't believe you. You just arrived here the same as us, so I know the jig is up. You don't have to play with me. You're not from here.
What do you mean, here?
Dex, what's your read on this guy?
Well, I've got a new focus now that I'm back on Earth.
All you guys re-rolled your focus, and it was, I think it was calculates the incalculable?
Calculates the incalculable. So something can like I take a round to eye him?
Yes, you can.
We're all just waiting very quietly as Dex.
So the four of you are standing in the room. It's well lit, and again, the setting sun of New York City with a bizarre skyline and the big Nazi blimp kind of sits in the background. Again, the gentleman that entered the room and gave you a curt nod has left now, and you're again standing amongst these trinkets as this fourth man just kind of appeared before you and kind of accepted that everything was normal. Dex, you take a moment and give him a good look, and I'll let the rest of you do an action before Dex does anything.
Well, I walk up to him and I say, whoever you are, it seems that you're a traveler of sorts in the same way that we are. My name's Sly Fitzgerald.
Sly, nice to meet you. Effort Bellwater.
Bellwater? Effort. Yes. Nice to meet you, Effort. This is Liam and my friend Dex over there, who's trying to get a read on you right now. We're not sure where we are.
Nice to meet you. Dex, very nice to meet you as well.
Oh, hold on. I'm still reading.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt your reading.
Well, Effort, did you... I mean, we don't have to play this game. Did you just arrive here the same way we did?
What do you mean the same way you did? How do I know I can trust you?
Well, I guess you can't, but the same goes for you. I guess we don't really need to work together on this.
Is there a sparkle in your eye?
Sparkle?
Yeah. Do I see a sparkle in your eye? There, Sly?
Yeah, you could say that I've seen some things.
Okay.
Gives me that sparkle.
You know what? Fair enough. What's your friend Dax there going to tell me?
So, Justin, you're looking over him, and you can give a roll now at a reduced difficulty. And basically, I'll let you know what his intentions are. And, Alex, you can kind of roll your skill, which would be, I guess, deceive, if you would like to.
Absolutely.
And, yeah. And I don't remember the rules, so we're just going to say whichever one's sort of higher.
All right. So I rolled a 12.
Okay. But we're going to lower it by whatever 12 would be. So, no. Alex fails anyway. So, Dex, you give him a look over, and Effort, you, what does he see about your character? What does he leak a little bit?
You're asking me what does he see?
Yeah. I mean, you're a human, or you're a person like anyone else. What does he see about you?
Well, he sees that, although I'm dressed in the right area, I'm definitely not wearing a Nazi uniform. I'm also very well spoken, and I seem more, maybe less in my place than I should be for this.
Yeah, perfect. Position. So yeah, that's exactly. So Dex, you do get the sense that he is a traveler of sorts, but there's also a quickness behind his eyes that says that he is knowledgeable of sort of where he is in the world. But you can tell that when he's talking to Sly, what he seems like he's trying to deduce is whether you guys fit into this world or whether you are travelers as well. Because you guys know that the spark is something given to recursive characters that just means they're aware of their place. Doesn't necessarily mean they're travelers.
Okay. So I lean over to Liam and I say, he doesn't have a Nazi accent. I think we can trust him.
A Nazi New York accent?
No, he doesn't have it.
Did he have an object, Harlan, when he came? Like, we had the... Now, we're no longer touching the Holy Grail.
Yeah.
Right, behind the glass.
Exactly. So, no, he doesn't have an object that you can see on him. And again, you know from what the witch said that there's a few different ways you can translate. One of the easiest, if you've never been anywhere before, is by using an object.
I put myself between the object and him. Just in case, for some reason, he's after it. Because it seems like it's a very important object based on what the witch told us. So I want to be between the new guy, Effort, and the Holy Grail.
Okay.
Effort, you seem like a friendly fellow. That handshake, by the way. Yeah, there you go.
Okay. Very nice to meet you, Dex.
Yeah. Likewise. How did you get here? What are you doing here? What's your story?
Well, I think you guys already know by now that I'm not from this recursion.
No.
I don't think you guys are either.
No, we're not. Right? No, we are, Sly? Are we? No, we're not.
No, well, it's too late now. No, we're not.
Fair enough. But I can tell you... I don't know. I always have to watch myself. It's hard to be in my position, because I can't always divulge all of the information that's being processed in my mind right now. If you could respect that.
Well, sir, Mr. Effort.
Yes, Liam, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Yeah, not to be rude, but is Effort your real name?
Absolutely. my birth
That's
name.
That's someone's banner down there. So
wait till he switches to his alternate banner.
Bellwater.
Excellent. Okay, so there's the four of you standing there. You're all kind of not really moving too much because you're really trying to figure out what the hell's going on. Something threw you for a loop. And Effort, you're standing there trying to size up exactly where these guys came from and what are they doing. And the three of you are kind of trying to figure out what's going on. And you remember that the three of you are trying to hunt down the drifter that brought you to the first recursion named Crax. And you're not sure what Effort is doing there just yet. But as the four of you are standing there, the gentleman, dressed in full Nazi garb, again, walks into the room and snaps his heels. Gentlemen, now we have 1 minute to go! And he almost runs out of the room.
I stand there, I was like, well, perhaps we should follow. That seemed like it was desperately in a hurry, so maybe there's something blowing up.
We should.
That's just Nazi accent.
Oh, yeah, I can also do that. No, that's not it.
Let me work on it, Liam.
Oh,
that's not right.
Excellent. So the four of you exit the room, and you enter a long marble hall with a red carpet in the middle, and you can see him walking very briskly up ahead of you, and along the walls are beautiful tapestries and paintings and things like that of the early 1900s, maybe mid-1900s era. They don't seem to... And in the room that you left, the museum, along with the Grail, there were tons of trinkets. Some of them seemed religious and in kind of context. Some of them were just tapestries, and this kind of seemed like a collections room of sorts. However, while it seemed important, the fact that you were kind of just standing in there, it doesn't make it seem too important. And he actually goes to the end of a fairly long hall, and he waves you, and he enters into a side room to the left.
Where do you think we're going, Sly?
I don't know. I don't even know what kind of place we're in right now. If the Nazis have taken over, I can't imagine it's a great place.
Do you think this is Earth? Do you think this is what happened when we left?
It looks like New York to me. I've only seen in pictures and stuff, but that looks like the New York skyline, or at least somewhat. And the Zeppelin in the sky, that's pretty ominous.
Wait, does this mean that we're in the past right now?
I think we're in some sort of alternate timeline where the Nazis took over.
Okay.
But the past would make sense if they're still flying Zeppelins.
Unless that's as far as their technology went once they burnt all the books.
Once they burnt all the books.
We don't need to learn.
We have Zeppelins.
Guys, my input, I say we follow him. Put on your best Nazi impersonation, because
I'll,
this is not...
I'll be quiet then, because that's not going to work out for me.
Trust me, it'll pass. This is not real New York. This is not real time. Mm. This is simply a recursion. Don't forget that.
You've done this before, then.
Unfortunately, yes. I am here for a reason, and it does not involve you guys, but I'm glad you're here, because you know what? I can always use extra help.
You kind of showed up at the same time as us.
Unshot, Dax, you're getting it. We're doing
it. Is this it? I don't sound Japanese anymore.
So as you approach the end of the hall, you start hearing a commotion, like a fair number of people. It's not in loud tones, it's relatively hushed, but you can hear like a large crowd. And there is the left that he kind of ducked into, the Nazi leader he kind of ducked into, and you can follow him in, but it seems to be rather dark.
Oh. Is it dark in here? Why do we not turn on lights? Yeah?
I don't know, but I think for this, my name will be Hans Ziga.
Ziga.
That's not offensive.
You're bad. It's the most
I have like three times.
Very bad at.
I will also be Hans Ziga.
All I can say is Sie lieb dich, ja. Sie lieb dich, ja, ja, ja. That's all I got. So, let's see if that comes into play.
So you enter the dark room, and you can hear a voice saying, come as ye here, schnell. You're kind of feeling your way into the dark, and you can already hear that the crowd is growing closer. And as you move your way through, your feet step on kind of a creaking wood. And someone grabs your shoulders, not harshly, but each of you, and they sort of push you into a spot.
Is that the Hunter Olsen?
And as they kind of lead you to somewhere, they tap you on the back, and you hear them whisper something German in your ear. And they kind of go away. And you're just kind of standing there for a second. And as you are, you can feel your heart pounding, and you hear that kind of crowd stop. And as the four of you are standing, Effort, you're kind of standing. They've actually moved you into a pose, sort of like this. And Sly, they've actually moved you into a pose. They may ask you to cross your arms and put your hand on your chin like this. Dex, they've actually made you kneel and do one of these where you're actually looking out.
Ah, we're a boy band.
And Liam,
yeah?
As you're talking, they're slapping you like, quiet, quiet. And they make you put your hand out like this, straight up into the air. And again, they whisper something in German, and the curtains are drawn. And for a moment, as the lights are just beginning to dim, you see the eyes of thousands of people in the audience. And a gentleman walks in on stage before you and addresses the audience. And he says, "Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show." And it goes into thunderous applause, and the crowd goes nuts. And as you're hearing this, you kind of look around, and you see behind you the visual display of New York City on fire, it almost looks like. And the gentleman continues, he says, "Tonight we are premiering our well-practiced play written by Heinrich Schmindler." And again, the crowd goes crazy clapping. And he says,
"Schmindler's List?
Ladies and gentlemen, the famous players straight from New York City, their home," and again, thunderous applause, "we present how the Germans won the war." And they all go crazy. And he bows as he walks off the stage. And the light comes up on you, Liam.
"Well, taking over New York was not very hard, as we are by far the superior race."
And you hear some laughs through the audience.
"We have the strength."
"I'm Winston Churchill, and I'm here to ruin your momentum and defeat all of you."
And I walk over to Dex, and I rip off the Nazi emblem on his guard. "He's undercover! Get him!"
And as you do that, the audience is just kind of quiet. And everything on the stage is very awkward and silent. All you hear is the scuffling shoes as you all kind of run around smacking each other.
"No!
Same time for Hitler.
We are so powerful!
Oh, so powerful!
I cannot stand under the enormous weight of the Blitzkrieg! Oh, United States, please help us!"
I start doing backflips and stuff too, just to entertain.
What?
And I'll try to do like backflips and stuff on the stage.
Okay, so you're all kind of doing your own shit. Okay, so Sly, you're backflipping weirdly.
Yeah.
And Dex, you're standing at the front of the stage doing like a Winston Churchill impression. And Liam, what are you doing?
I am making my way up to Winston Churchill and pelvic thrusting behind him.
So you're just pelvic thrusting behind Winston Churchill. And Effort, what are you doing?
I'm dancing around pretending I've got guns and I'm shooting. I'm laughing.
Okay, so you're all kind of doing weirdly random things. And the audience...
keep on looking silent.
And the audience is just like, yeah, it's super, super quiet. And they're like... and they're just watching.
So I'm looking at the audience. Do they are they dressed like us?
You can't see. Unfortunately, the stage lights are way too bright. And you can't quite see. You can only kind of see the reflections of their eyes.
I start just interpretively dancing, like turning into like a big art piece. And I walk over and I do it over to Dex and I say, make it more modern so that it's more ambiguous. They can come up with their own decisions about what the play is about. And I start moving in these very over-the-top gestures, and I start taking pieces of my clothing off and tie them to my head and you know, interpretive dancing.
All so as you're doing that, the stage lights are trying to follow you all too, right? Because this is a well-rehearsed play that whatever the hell's going on, someone must think you're having like some sort of mental breakdown. But they're watching it, and everyone's kind of like adjusting in their seats, like,
okay. And I whisper while I'm doing actions, and I whisper to the other three guys here that I've just literally just met, and I'm like, okay, guys, we gotta get a story here and make this believable. Otherwise, we're gonna get, you know, be taken away and probably tortured. Dax, continue with the whole Churchill thing and pretend you're a plane. And Liam and Sly, let's be Nazi fighters and we'll take them down and we'll bomb New York. And Dax, then pretend to be the New York fighting back and we'll take you out too.
Success is what they want, right? And then, again, the audience just kind of looks on in a bizarre, kind of confused state, and you're kind of huddling for a second, and then you all kind of break out, and the lights kind of dim for a second and come back up, and the spotlight shines on you.
And we start running around like this?
Yeah. Okay, so you're all running around acting like planes.
Yep.
Well, actually, at this point, I walk to the front of the stage,
okay.
And again, I click my heels.
Yep.
Yeah, perfect. Okay.
This is what your play would look like if New York had of won.
And it's met with superior mind,
superior skill, and superior intellect. We were able to play Gone Wrong with a Hanziga.
And every word that you say, they kind of get it, and you can hear like a... Oh,
satire.
They're like, it's stupid because we won, or if we didn't win, and they kind of get it. But because it's only been like a 5 minutes, they're all still kind of confused as you're staying on the page, and everyone in the background is kind of zipping around.
Let my friends show you what we have done through our superior aeronautic development. And how we were able to bomb the rest of the world.
And okay.
I guess I got to stick with Adi.
He's Austrian. I stand there and I start watching these other guys because I'm starting to go, I don't know what we're doing anymore.
So the two of you, so Dex and Effort, you're going around the stage in aeroplanes.
I start making more aeroplanes. I want to go into the audience and like walk out the back.
You actually leave.
No, I get down off the stage, so it seems like it's like one of those plays where they go into the audience. And
okay.
I start flying around the audience to get a look at the audience to see if they're Nazis at all.
Okay, so you get down and you start doing that, yeah.
And I go, yeah, you better run, you American wussies.
Oh, okay. So they're kind of getting it, and they're like, oh, and you're running up and down, and the theater's filled with men, women, children, but they're all dressed very fancy. This seems to be like a very high end play. It was meant to be, maybe. Dax, what are you doing?
Well, I'm still kind of running around, and eventually I stop by Effort, who says that, and I say, "Whoa, man, I'm having a lot of fun." And then and then I start singing. I think of a song that
Edelweiss.
I heard a long time ago, and I start singing Edelweiss.
Okay.
Edelweiss. Edelweiss, and I like and start gesturing for the
and
audience.
As you do, you actually hear all the seats in the audience like move, and everybody stands like it's their new anthem for some reason, and they're all like singing along, and the audience is like Edelweiss, and you all kind of stop, and you're all singing with it, I guess, and even the guy who announced you kind of steps up from backstage and he starts singing too, and all the stagehands walk out as well, and they do the same thing. And the whole theater is now filling with Edelweiss.
I lie down in bed on the floor as if I died and list down. I don't know. It's artistic.
Do you come back on stage or do you do it?
Yeah, well, after that, I take the whatever my costume is with the thing around my head and put it on properly and go sing as well.
Okay. Perfect. Effort, what are we doing?
And then I was just going to say, and then as soon as the song's done, I say,
take a bow.
Take the bow. Take a bow.
It's as good as it's going to get.
Yeah.
So you, at the end of Edelweiss, it kind of concludes. Everyone is standing there, and thunderous applause happens, and the curtains get drawn. And the guy who announced it, and you can hear like shuffling out there, and the guy who announced you kind of walks over, and he's holding a playbill in his hand, kind of crunched. And you assume now he's sort of like the director of sorts. Mm. And he looks down, he's like, 100 pages of work. 7 years it took me to get us this far. 7 years. And you can see him starting to shatter. Does anyone want to try to roll something on him?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, what are you going to roll?
I say, don't you remember, Mr. Director? We changed it late last night over many, many German beers.
Schnapps.
And schnapps.
Okay, so you're going to try a deception, and because you have a deception benefit, it's going to be lowered one tier. So go ahead.
14.
Oh, interesting. Okay, so that succeeds. So you see him looking down. Did we change it?
Can I walk up and can I see it? I'm pretty sure we changed it. May I read what we had?
And he hands it to you, and it looks normal.
I want to read what kind of play it was supposed to
be. It's like a legitimate serious play. Like it starts off with a monologue, and like Hitler and Winston Churchill aren't even in it. You all played soldiers and stuff.
Okay, I say, yeah, definitely we changed this part, and that's where the Edelweiss comes in, and I show him in, you know, the third scene.
And he's like, then I am brilliant! And he turns around, and he like pushes himself out of the thing, and he's like, I am brilliant! Yes. And again, you can hear throughout the thing like there's like an applause. And the stagehands are all cleaning up, and they're all kind of nodding to each other. A few of them are like, huh? And then they're just like, whatever.
Germans don't. By, I'll be like, it's art.
It's art. Get it.
You will not understand it's art.
Perfect. So
you don't have to understand it.
Yeah. So again, the curtains are now drawn, and the lights of the backstage are a little clearer now, and everyone's kind of just going about their business, and it looks like there's only the one way in or the stage.
And there's probably a back door, isn't there not? Like a stage door?
There is. There's a stage door outside.
So I turn to these three, and I say, okay, now, before anybody's looking, let's go. And I like point to the back door. And I move towards it.
Wait, Effort, it says we have a matinee coming up tomorrow morning.
It does. This is the matinee, actually.
Look at the schedule. This show. Is the matinee. We got another show tonight, man.
Yes, you're right, Dax, but that's not important now. What's important is the mission. Follow me.
Okay, so you guys head to the back door, and there's a stagehand there, and it's kind of propped open with a brick, and he's just kind of smoking, and he kind of nods to you, and he's like, I don't get art.
And are we, like, inside the building still, or is this the back alley?
You head out, and it's like an alleyway, but awesome. The minute you open the door, you see, like, 15 people, and they all start screaming. And they're holding playbills out, and they're like, oh. And Liam, one woman runs up to you, and she says, oh my god, you were so brilliant. Please sign my playbill.
And I'll just do, like, the scribble so you couldn't read it anyway.
Yeah.
And she faints. She's like, oh, as she does. And they're all kind of crowding, and they're all like, oh my god, so good. And Dex, one guy corners you, and he's like, oh my god, where did you get your inspiration for your portrayal of Winston Churchill?
I watched a lot of History Channel growing up. Mostly in my mind, actually. Like, I did a lot of reading.
Wait, hold on, what do you mean history? Like, what's History Channel? What do you mean?
History Channel. Oh, it's this game I make up in my head.
And he just kind of looks at you.
Yeah.
He turns to Sly. Sly, oh my god, so beautiful. And when you came down, he doesn't say Sly, but he says, you're so beautiful. When you came to the audience and you started running around, was that scripted or did you just feel the moment?
Well, I think the director, what he was trying to say is that the enemy is really amongst us, and we need to be constantly aware of that. But still, the power of Germany still overcomes it all once we have Edelweiss sung. Really, our spirit comes together and defeats us, even if they're amongst the amongst us.
Oh my God! Exactly. I totally agree. And he asked you to assign his playbill as well.
And I do, and I sign it, again allegedly.
Okay. And effort, just girls are just hugging you. They're just like.
And you know, as much as I love that, I'm eyeing everybody in the crowd. I'm looking at everybody's face, almost to the point where it's odd, but not noticeably odd to the fans, right? But
okay.
I'm looking for somebody, yeah. and I'm watching what these guys are doing and continuing.
What are you looking for? Clearly. You're distracted. What are we supposed to be looking for?
Your eyes lock on to actually someone as you're answering him. And a gentleman in a Nazi's general cap kind of pushes through the crowd and comes up to the four of you. And he says, "Gentlemen, if you have a moment." And he steps kind of just off to the side a little bit away from the crowd. As they're all kind of now getting their signatures. And Liam, you're signing them as they're pulling you away as you're getting the last one. You guys are like the Beatles.
I'll sign someone's.
No one has.
You're like Ringo.
I'll do it. Well, I don't like
that. Oh yeah, Dax.
So he pulls you aside and says, "Gentlemen," and he's removing a glove as he does in very Nazi fashion.
The Führer was very impressed by your play today. He wishes to thank you personally. I have a car waiting. If you would like to follow me.
And he puts the glove back on, and he turns down a side alley, and as you kind of see straight down, there's a limousine door open.
I don't see why we wouldn't, guys.
Yeah,
might as well. I mean, he seems like a nice enough fellow. He has nice gloves, yeah?
Yeah.
So you all follow?
But before we get in, I need to talk to my other actors here. Give us 1 second, yeah?
And you can see, based on his medals and stuff, he's a high-ranking official, and he kind of... very well. I'll wait around the corner. And he kind of just takes a few steps ahead. But he's out of earshot.
I turn... So now we've kind of got a bit to ourselves, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I turn to these guys, and I present my... what the fuck's it called? My estate badge.
Okay. So he flashes you a metallic-looking badge that you've never seen before. It looks bizarre, but it does have thick lettering on it, and it seems relatively authentic. And as you kind of look at it, you kind of reach a hand out, and you get a sense of a power from it, something that you felt in your previous translation. And again, you guys are all the same shape and size relatively, but your facial features have changed. Sly, you no longer have a beard, and your broken nose is now relatively straight, and you have more of a crew cut. Dex, similar with you, you have a bit more of a beard. And Liam, you have a mustache, and you're actually bald. Sorry, buddy.
That all happened when I showed them my badge?
No, this is in this translation. I never explained.
Why would you show that to us?
No, but Dex, you do get a sense of power from it, as if it's you know.
Okay, you're showing us a badge right now. What does that mean, Effort? I can tell it's just not just any regular badge.
Yes. I am an officer with the estate. I presume you've heard of the estate?
Never. No, not in my life. Not in my life.
Okay. Well, basically, more or less, what I'm telling you is that I work with the estate and I govern all the laws on Earth and all the recurrences.
So clearly, something's going. If we take you at your word, something wrong is happening in this incursion.
Unless this is your law, did you enforce this?
No. No, absolutely not. I'm just doing my job, as any other estate agent would be doing. But I'm looking for somebody, and I need your guys' help because obviously,
Up to this point, I've been unsuccessful. I'm looking for a drifter. He's eluded me so far. He's this criminal, and he needs to be brought in for justice.
What's his name?
Jinx, personal jinx lie.
You know what? That's confidential information until I know I can trust you guys. What are you doing here, and how do I know that you guys are not drifters?
Well, we're looking for a guy named Crax. I think Crax.
And I elbow Dex in the rib cage.
What? That's what we're here for.
Yeah, but he doesn't know if he can trust us. Maybe this guy's Crax.
I know.
Maybe he's Crax. Do you think that? Maybe he's the guy.
We just did an entire performance with the guy. We can trust him.
How do you know? We can't. In the last place we were, there was ogres, and there was a computer world, and I can't trust. I can barely trust you, Dex.
All right. Well, sorry. Well, forget that last bit, Effort. Let me just talk.
Yeah, Effort. Forget about that guy.
That guy.
We're here because we're trying to get home.
Yeah. But how did you get here? You know, what's stopping me from taking you guys in right now? How do I know you guys aren't one of the drifters I'm looking for?
Well, why would you take us in? You've got an entire world of Nazis here. Come on.
Can you bring us back to Earth?
Are you guys trying to get back to Earth?
Yes.
Do you have the ability to get us back home?
But not just back home. We need to go back into the bodies we belong to, like our Earth bodies.
So you're in a bit of a situation, eh?
You could say that. Maybe we are, maybe we aren't.
I'll tell you what. I do not have the ability to do that. But I'm sure that if you were to help me, I could probably talk to the estate and see about getting you guys home.
Well, what does this drifter do?
I just still don't understand what you're doing here. Because only a drifter could illegally move through these recursions as you guys have.
Well, to be completely honest with you, Mr. Bellwater, I don't really know how we got here either. We started in this weird place, which was like a fairy tale land. Have you heard of a fairy tale land?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, for sure.
There was a king there, and there was a tower. I've got his memoirs. Oh, but I guess I don't have his memoirs. Do I have his memoirs?
Yeah, because it was an artifact.
Oh, okay. So I show him the memoirs just to show him that we're on the level.
Look, if you're talking about Daventry, I've been to Daventry. Oh. If you're talking about... You name it, I've probably been there.
All right.
I know you guys are not the one I'm looking for. Or do I?
Do I?
I think you know.
There's four of us. Clearly, we all can't be the person you're looking for.
There's three of us.
Right.
Plus that.
Listen.
And the narrator kind of counts.
Yeah, he's... Narrator?
The narrator counts in the same way that you count as people.
Mm-hmm. Jesus Christ. Did you hear that?
That's weird.
We can't not hear it, actually.
It's been kind of following us around.
You play by the rules of the recursion, and you'll be fine. You'll live.
Okay, what are the rules of the recursion?
It's not Earth. This is not Earth. This is a little different, okay? Just go along with it. Don't stick out like a sore thumb. Don't tell anybody else that you're in a recursion. They don't realize that they're in a recursion. Okay?
Right.
So
before we get into the limo...
walks over to you and kind of interrupts and says, gentlemen, please, you do not want to keep the Führer waiting.
Okay, let's go.
And he turns and marches down the alley... Goose steps down the alley.
So very quietly under my breath, and I'm not even paying attention. I'm walking back behind with Liam and Sly, and I'm humming Stars and Stripes Forever.
Oh, shit.
And,
just very quietly.
And he opens the door, and he lets you in. And as you pass him, you actually hear he was humming too, and he goes,
Nice.
And you enter the back of the thing, and he gets in, and he shuts the door. And it's like the four of you are in one seat at the back, because nobody moved it around to the other side. And he's like, it's nice cozy back here, yeah?
Yeah.
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 Yeah. And he actually puts his arm on Liam's leg. You don't mind, do you?
No, it's not my first time.
Very good, very good. Driver, take us to
my face.
Take us to the Führer, please.
And the guy rolls in the window, turns around and says,
yeah.
And you can hear the car start up.
Is there a bottle of like champagne or schnapps or anything I can open up?
And he says, ah, yes, we do actually have a bottle of Jagermeister.
And he grabs it and he opens up this interesting bottle and smells of herbs.
Jagermeister, Jagermeister. And he pours four glasses. A toast to a fantastic matinee. I'll pour three shots for each person. You only say three like this, not like this.
Never mind.
Does it taste good?
No, it doesn't particularly. Jager does not taste good. It's only for girls in college. Anyway, so you're drinking it, and after a very short ride, it stops. And the car's older, and this is a 1940s-ish car. And as he opens the door, because you went straight from the alley into the car, you don't quite see it. And as he opens the door and you step out, you see it. Downtown New York. Pieces of buildings being reconstructed. You see the blimps overhead. You see the people in the streets, and it feels like it's the 1940s.
Well, I look around. Are there any taxis? Are there... What's the feel? Does it feel like New York in the 1940s?
It feels like New York under another power. There are people walking the streets, very quiet, kind of holding packages, kind of looking around. There are Germans patrolling the streets, not in an intimidating way, but just kind of keeping the peace. Sections of road are kind of blocked off. It seems like they have occupied New York, but it seems like maybe there's some trouble doing it.
Oh.
And where is he leading us?
He points to a very large tower next to you, and it looks like, back then, 30 or 40 story tower. Massive! And he points to it, and he says, this way! And he walks to the door.
Harlan, yeah. I have a question for you. My character, would I recognize the guy I'm looking for?
No, you don't know what he looks like.
Okay. I ask him, I say, why does the Führer want to speak to us?
He kind of looks at you and he says, because you put on a magnificent performance, of course.
Wait, so he came to our performance... But then left right away, went back to his tower, and then is waiting for us to join him.
And he says, oh, don't be silly. The Führer doesn't leave the tower. He sends other people to watch the plays and report to him. But the report he received was absolutely magnificent, and he wants to thank you personally.
That is a very fast report.
And he walks into the tower, and you enter a beautiful, large marble lobby with the swastika banners hanging on either side, and you walk up a quick set of steps, and he presses the elevator call button. He kind of just sits there.
Does he have a firearm strapped to his waist?
Yes, he does. A German Luger.
So, what is it like to be an actor? I saw all those women all over you. So exciting.
Yeah, not that exciting. I'm gay. Duh.
Really? What? What?
It's a joke! It's a joke! It's funny!
Joke? I'm joking!
Oh, no! Of course you're joking. Yes. No, and you can kind of see when he says that he's kind of like a little shy. He's like, yes, it must be nice having women all over you. Mm.
You, as a officer, must have many women all over you.
Oh, it's not... Don't... No. And he kind of opens... The elevator opens and he walks inside. Come here. You're flatterers. I see why you're so popular. Come in.
And then I
turn... Is there a button that says boss?
No, it says Führer.
Yeah. I turn to Sly and I say, I don't know if I trust this Führer fellow.
I don't know if I trust my accent.
I don't know if I trust you guys.
So the elevator starts rising, and the officer's still blushing a little bit, and he's kind of just twitching in his seat. He's like, or twitching as he stands, kind of like, I must say, I saw it as well, and you, sir, and he turns to you, Liam, you were my absolute favorite. Your portrayal of the Führer in the center of the stage, it was absolutely chilling. You had the same amount of power behind your speaking as he did. It's absolutely wonderful. I just want to say that.
That is... Oh, that's very kind. Sigail!
and he's doing it the whole time, but again, very little flimsy, kind of like,
hi, Hilda's, hi, Heil.
And so the doors open, and he's kind of blushing, and he steps off. And it's a massive room, and there's two beautiful big oak wooden doors with black bars on them. And the walls are kind of like Wolfenstein. They got like bricks of like cement on them and stuff like that.
And there's a blonde girl
sitting at the desk. What's that?
Oh, I was going to say, when we recognize it as Wolfenstein, I turn to Liam to see if he notices the same thing.
And you do. Yeah, you're like,
As we step off the elevator,
yeah,
I turn back to the guys and I kind of whisper, I'm looking for the same actor that you guys are looking for. I should have just been up front with you.
And he keeps moving forward. And as you enter the big room, you see a desk sitting out front, and there's a beautiful blonde woman sitting there. And he stops walking. And you can kind of see him twitching. And he kind of turns and says, oh, and he keeps going forward. And hello,
Zahilga.
And he kind of coughs as he does it.
Hello, Zahilga. How are you doing? We're here to see the Führer.
And she kind of looks up from her desk and says,
oh, hi, Oscar. Who's this?
And he kind of goes, oh, these are actors. And she goes,
oh, from the new play.
And I walk up and I say, yes, but we never would have learned anything if it wasn't for Oscar. He showed us everything. I can do a French accent. He showed us everything we know.
And she goes,
and I wink at Oscar.
Is that true, Oscar? And he goes, well, I wouldn't say it's not true. Oh! And they both kind of giggle in a weird German. and she says, ah, yes, you can see the Führer now. And he says, ah, yes, 1 minute, please. And he goes into the doors. He walks to the massive doors. And there's a smaller door, actually smaller than regular size, that he opens within it and steps in and shuts it behind him. And you're waiting there for a few minutes. And again, the lobby is pretty straightforward. There's little plants and stuff like that. And she's just kind of typing away. And eventually, he comes back out. And he has a little piece of paper with him. And he shuts it behind him. He says, gentlemen, the Führer has personal congratulations. And he hands it to you.
I take it. And I read it.
It's a single piece of paper, just not even folded. It's just one single piece of paper, blank on one side. And the other side just says, well done. But the writing looks almost like a child wrote it. Like it's very, very scribbled. And it's almost, it might be crayon. And Oscar's just smiling at you. Well, there you go. It was so great for you to be up here. Of course, not many people get this honor. Very nice.
But
this is, of course, what?
Do we get to meet the Führer?
Oh, no. No one meets the Führer. He's very, very reclusive since winning the war, so we don't speak to the Führer. But he gives out personal congratulations almost as rarely. So you should feel very honored with that. It's very good. It's probably worth something in a few years. Don't let him hear that. He'll be very offended.
And I'm looking it over. Is that all there is to it, or is there?
It's literally all there is to it. It's even less than I described. Like the well done doesn't even have an E on it. It's well done.
Did you read these congratulations?
And he looks at it and says, yes, very nice. It's very good of him. Now, this is, of course, a hotel, and Zephyrho wanted to extend his personal congratulations by upgrading you from the Master Suite to the Master Race Suite. So we've gone ahead and put that for you. It is just the two floors below us, one of the nicest rooms in the entire hotel. It has enough beds for all of you. So please have at it, and you can stay here for the duration of your play. Nope. I will have someone Oscar. Send you down there immediately.
Oscar, before we go, I have a question.
Yeah?
We have time before our next play. Perhaps you could join us for dinner. I have a shitty accent.
Oh, I would love to. I think that would be absolutely wonderful.
No. Do you imagine that Olga would like to join us?
No, I'm sorry?
Olga.
And he turns around and she's kind of blushing. Me? And he goes, and he's getting really nervous. He says, what, maybe this would not work, but I don't know, dude, you don't have to say yes, don't feel obligated. And she kind of says, yeah, I would love to.
Okay, what do you say around 6 o'clock?
And he gets excited, he says, yeah, this is fantastic. We'll go somewhere nicer. I was thinking mixed sauerkrauts, but we'll do something else. Something like nice. There's a hotel bar which is fantastic. It's wonderful food. And Helga kind of lights up and he says, yes, I will come to the Master Race Suite around 5:45 and we will come pick you up. He says, wunderbar, wunderbar. And as he does, someone walks in, another Nazi, and he says hi to Oscar, and he goes, hi, Hitler. Please take them to the Master Race Suite. It's going to be a very fun night. And he kind of clicks his heels, and he walks away. He says, thank you, right on. And
Oscar, before you go.
And he stops.
No. Come a little closer.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I had forgot that we need to practice our lines, or we will not know for the play.
Yeah.
Perhaps you and Helga could have a nice meal on us.
And he goes beet red, and he turns to Helga.
No, she's already. She. This is. I didn't want her to be near it.
Oh, okay. I see what you're saying. So he goes.
What? Just be like, oh no, we could make it.
But Helga won't want to go if it's just me. She won't only want to go because of you.
Oh,
but why not? Oscar,
I believe you will do fine.
But do you really think so?
You are a smart, attractive man. Go see her.
Your German is very, very good. And he kind of nods. He says, very well. I will come pick her up here at 6 o'clock. I will have to figure out someone to watch the Führer. But that doesn't matter now. I will do this. Thank you. And he reaches out. He shakes your hand. He shakes each of your hands. Thank you. Oh! And he runs out of the room. And the other Nazi says, gentlemen, I would like to show you to your suite.
Is he a big black guy?
Yes, we are all shapes and sizes. And he takes you back to the elevator, and you ride down a couple steps, and opens up, and it's just one massive door, and it says Master Race Suite. And he opens it up, and it's beautiful beyond belief, gold trim and everything. And he kind of curtly nods, and says, if there's anything, buzz the front desk. And he shuts the door. And the four of you are alone.
So, I don't know if the Führer is all he's cracked up to be.
I mean, look at his handwriting. It looks like he's a child. But we do know that Oscar will be away, so we do have the opportunity to try to sneak in later.
Mm-hmm.
Well done, Liam.
Look, guys.
Yes.
I should have just been up front with you right away. I am looking for cracks.
Like not butt another
cracks.
One.
Not butt cracks.
Normal.
I hate these recursions.
Cracks the Drifter.
And what do you intend to do once you find him?
Well, I have to take him back to justice. I have to take him back to Earth. That's what I've been told I have to do.
Is there any way
right now? Bear with me.
So back to Earth.
He's got to put on laundry.
Yes, back.
I've got to print something. He's got to do laundry. Sorry.
Back to Earth. Yes. I'll tell you this then. The four of you are sitting around in the hotel, and you're all kind of being comfort yourself with the room, and you're looking out, and as you flip on the TV, you see the news report, and it's like CNN, and like there's an anchor there sitting there, but she's just like crying a little bit, and she's like, though many haven't seen Hitler in years, support for the party is still very strong. Back to you, Tom. And then there's a guy like on the thing, you know, doing weather or some shit, and he's like, the whole east coast of New Germany is sunny and bright, while the west coast of New Germany is, and he's referring to like a map of like just North America. And you can see like little random spots of like Germany, and all the rain symbols are little like swastikas and things like that. And he's like, back to you, Becky. And everything seems just kind of like turned on its head and a little bizarre. And yeah, I mean, you watch the TV for a few minutes and you're just flipping through and you see like Simpsons are now like the Skinsons? No, that could be edgy. But you see like everything is like bizarro TV, like Superman is no longer Superman. He's like super Nazi.
Führerman.
Führerman. And like kids shows are like just totally different. Like
the Simpsons are the Simpsons are the SS Simpsons.
The SS Simpsons. The Simpsons. And it's just everything's kind of turned on its head. And only a few minutes of watching TV, you see that this is totally different. It is current era, but it's the 1940s. Like for whatever reason, they didn't proceed forward in certain really key areas. Like the blimp, the cars, and the hotel, but you have telephones and television and other things like that.
And I flip through to see if there's a History Channel.
Ah. Yeah, so you do. So you find History Channel, and it's like sort of the same story that you're familiar with, but on the other side. It's like,
right.
And our grand leader, Hitler, then did the clever move of deciding to invade at a different time.
For thousands of years, whites were oppressed.
Yeah. So it just kind of spins everything on the head. And even now, you can tell that all the bad, really bad things that happened still happened, but they were like kind of glossed over and they changed them. It's like, after putting it to a Senate vote, all camps were opened and let people come free because North America had plenty of space for the new people and stuff like that. And there's like Canada is now just for all the people that Germany doesn't want. That's where we are. And that's how Canada got born. We're multicultural. But yeah, everything seems weird. And the history is very similar, except for like a few key plot changes. But you haven't got to the point of the pivotal, because you're still watching like intently as Liam comes back from taking his poop. Because he did have to poop.
Liam, they said something about the Führer going missing. What do you think that's about? I don't know. I thought
before the crayon writing Führer or after the crayon writing Führer?
Hitler, I mean. Hitler. That Führer.
So, the Führer not Hitler now?
What if Krax took over as the Führer?
That's what I'm thinking.
Well, that's kind of drawing a lot of conclusions from not very much.
When did he go missing? Do we know?
No, the Führer never went missing. I never said that, did I?
Oh, no. I thought I heard that on the TV.
I thought he said on the TV that even though he hasn't been seen, when did he stop being seen? When did he stop being seen?
Yeah.
Okay, gotcha. Never mind. Okay. I watched a replay of it on TV, and now I get it.
But that was my question. When was the last time he'd been seen? Do we know?
So you keep watching, but it seems like they kind of glaze over that for whatever reason. But he seems to be in the building a few floors above you. So anyway, supposedly. So as you're standing there kind of talking... Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry, continue. Actually, I'll let you discuss a little more.
So like I was telling you guys, I am, in fact, looking for Krax. And it turns out so are you. And so, you know, it just happens that we have crossed our paths on this... in this recursion. Now, what I know is that Krax is not an evil man, and I don't think he's Hitler, or I don't think he's the Fuhrer. But
taken into context, that's the best line ever. I don't think this guy is Hitler. Because it's actually literal.
But, you know, keep in mind that we should be wary of not try. It's almost like the butterfly effect. You don't want to start changing the reality of this world by being too upfront with people about what we know. So keep that in mind.
So should we, like, do we have any leads to go on aside from the fact that we might want to see the Fuhrer?
No.
So as you're talking, you hear a knock.
Everybody, positions.
I stay where I am. I
just come in.
You take the positions on stage.
Y'all practicing.
So the door opens and in wheels a cart and a guy in like the hotel stuff. He says, "As the Fuhrer also wanted to bring you champagne." And German sauerkraut. And he opens it up and just like a bowl of sauerkraut. And he's like, this is my favorite sauerkraut. And I've been to McSauerkraut down this road, Sauerkraut King, Sauerkraut Way, and my favorite, which is just sauerkrauts. And this is my favorite sauerkraut, I must say. Although, sauerkraut chicken and fries is also quite good if you like that southern mix.
Southern mix.
And he kind of nods, and he says, I will double charge the room. And he walks out of the hotel room and shuts it.
Double charge? Really?
That's a lot of sauerkraut. It's a good amount of sauerkraut.
Well, and we didn't even ask for sauerkraut.
But it's nice.
That's okay. I step up to the sauerkraut, and I poke it.
Okay. You
poke it. Reach in, see if there's anything in there.
You actually do. You move a little bit of sauerkraut, and you see something white sticking in it.
Oh.
See? Poke the things.
It's a sauerkraut.
And I reach in, and I grab the white thing.
It's special sauce. Okay, so you pull
out who's using their shake weights?
You pull out a small piece of paper, and you brush off some of the delicious, delicious German sauerkraut, and it says, the resistance needs your help. And then it just says, room 312, immediately.
And I tuck it away, and I put it back in my pocket, and I start searching the sauerkraut for more. Is there a cipher in here?
Just kind of like starts going through your nose. And at the bottom, you don't really know, you don't find anything, but you do kind of smell the sauerkraut.
It's very crowdy.
And then I say, dig in, guys. And I go to the bar fridge and grab a Jaeger.
So you don't even tell them about the note?
They have Jaeger and German pop, which is called
Viking. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Guys, we got to get to room 312.
We don't know about that.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. No, I passed it over to Effort as I was going to the beer.
I'm going to do an incursion that you accidentally eat the note as well.
Oh, man. Okay.
That I eat the note? I didn't eat anything.
No, but that's the incursion, that you love it so much that you actually start eating the sauerkraut and you accidentally eat the number off the room. Just kind of take a bit of the paper.
Before you find it.
I wasn't eating anything, though.
The incursion is that you eat the sauerkraut.
I'm eating the sauerkraut right because I love vegetables. And I eat some of the note. And I say,
and I look over and I see Dax pull out a piece of paper from his mouth. I say, Dax, what's that paper?
I don't know. They dropped some paper in the sauerkraut. What? Don't blame me. Blame the chef. This is an outrage. There's no way they're double charging the room.
Well, what is it? What does it say?
It's been in my mouth. You open it.
So you pull it out, and it's only got the number 3 at the beginning.
Oh, God. 3.
It says, meet us in room 3 immediately.
Well, we know it's probably on the third floor.
Yeah.
How many rooms can there be?
Yeah, good point.
It just says, meet us in room 3. 3 doesn't say the resistance.
Yeah, it says everything up to the three. It says we need your help. The resistance, meet us immediately, room three.
Three, yeah, probably 312.
Oh, it looks like a three.
Yeah.
Let's try 312 first.
I like that idea. So
perfect.
I think we should wait until a little bit dark.
It says immediately.
Oh, does it?
Yeah.
Who wants to go?
Everyone raise their hands.
I guess we're
voting. Oh, I guess we don't have to do that, but it's really catching.
Hi, dude.
I just can't see any of this video being used out of context, and that's what I'm really excited about.
That's the best part. Okay, so you decide to go. So you can head down to level three.
Is it that way?
It's this way, it's that way, it's this way. You don't want to point down, because they always go up. Maybe they do go down. Hi, Hitler. Yeah. And as you go to open the door, you actually see two guards standing on the other side of your door.
Good evening. We are looking for the showers.
And they say, Guten Abend, there is a shower in your suite.
Yes, but the baths is what I meant.
There is a bath in your suite. You have the nicest feet. Please stay inside until your performance. And he shuts the door on you.
And I say, but what about the gym? Where's the gym?
What about the gym? Hello?
He says, you do not need a gym.
You're perfectly fit.
Yeah. And they're standing on either side of the door.
Bob says, well, let me introduce you to my wife, Michael. Gay Nazis.
Is there anything wrong with gay people?
So yeah, they're not letting you open the door.
No, it's the point that they were Nazis. That's the problem.
Yeah, that's the problem. Is that they're Nazis. Should have but they're right outside the door. Okay, is there a window in our room?
There is.
Guys, I've done this before. I've been an agent for a long time. Quick, tie the bed sheets together.
Don't you have any snipers? You didn't come prepared at all?
Do I have any snipers?
He has one cipher on him.
Is it a levitation cipher?
Never figured out what it did.
I never did?
You never checked what it is. Did someone get the wallet cipher last time?
Yeah.
I thought so.
I don't know.
I don't think anyone got it.
Okay, and Alex, you have the wallet cipher.
Okay, perfect. So, I knock. I open the door again, and they say, "Excuse me, I've got this wallet. It doesn't belong to either of you, does it?"
And both of the Germans look at you, and they look at the wallet.
Are we all there? Because I go, "Hey, that's my wallet."
Yeah, that's true, yeah.
I'm pretty sure it's my wallet!
And they go, no, that's my wallet. That's my wallet. And because he's holding it out, one of the guys grabs it. And the other one who's looking says, no, that's my wallet, Hans. That's mine. And he snatches it back. And they start arguing. No, it's my wallet. It's mine. This is mine. It's got a picture of my wife in it. And the other one's, there's no pictures in it. This is my wallet. And they start kind of moving down the hall as they're continually arguing.
Why are they taking my wallet?
Yeah, I Effer, why did you give him my wallet?
Oh, God. Oh, amateurs. And I say, okay, quick, follow me. Close the door behind you. Leave the lights on.
Can I bring the Jaeger?
Turn the TV up. Yeah, you can bring the sauerkraut. Would you ask? Can you bring...
The Jaeger.
Yeah, bring the Jaeger and bring the sauerkraut. You should never attend a party without bringing something.
It's true.
Okay, so.
Welcome to the party, pal. So as you kind of hit, you head for the elevator and you hit the elevator. And you wait as the guys are kind of arguing amongst themselves. And you keep waiting. And as you're waiting there, they kind of stop for a second and the one turns to the other one and goes, do you think we're the bad guys? And the other guy goes, no. And he says, but it just seems so
evil. Why do we have skulls on all of our stuff? He says, no, we're not the bad guys. We won. We're the good guys. And he goes,
death is our part of life.
I don't think we're the good guys. And then the elevator opens up behind you as they continue arguing with the wallet.
And I go like this, and I push the three of you into the
elevator.
Okay, oh. And the elevator shuts. Bing!
Which is I push Effort against the wall. Why did you have my wallet, Effort? Did you pickpocket me?
Sly, it was a cipher. Everybody sees that wallet, they think it's theirs. Trust me. Have I lied to you this far?
I don't know. You might be
I don't know, have you?
I'm a trustworthy person. I would never lie to you. Not in this lifetime, anyway.
Says the guy who just gave away my wallet.
You don't have to do that, Liam. We're alone now. No need for accents. But it is kind of
funny. Oh, yeah. Yeah, good point. All right. So press 3 on the elevator.
Perfect. So you press 3, and it starts moving. And you get to maybe floor 4, and the elevator stops.
Oh.
Should do that scary scene. And yeah. So let's take a look.
You guys know what they do in movies. Let's climb out through the hatch in the ceiling.
Oh, the doors aren't opening?
No.
Oh, I just assumed. Sorry.
We still have to do that, yeah.
No, but I like your style, Effort. Let's do it. Start poking open the top of the...
Okay, so you open it fairly easily, and it looks like an elevator shaft that goes straight up. Very typical of an elevator shaft. There's no ghouls in there.
It doesn't go diagonal?
Well, you know, those Nazis.
They're a little crooked.
Okay, is there any way we can slip beside the elevator so we can slide down the shaft or anything like that?
Are you getting up on top?
Yeah, I think so.
So you get up. I'm not going to make you roll because you took the athletics ability, or sorry, the excels and strength ability. So you're going to do it pretty much without any difficulty. And you get up on top of the elevator. And you're looking around, and there doesn't seem to be much space on either side of it. But you might be able, with a boost, to climb up to the next floor above it. And you basically have half a door of... You're kind of between the floors.
Between 3 and 4, or between 4 and 5?
So you could get a boost up and maybe wedge open the fifth floor door.
Okay, I let the guys in the down... I say, Liam, get up here. See if you can boost me up so we can get down to the fifth floor. Maybe we can take the stairs down to the third.
Okay.
Should have taken the stairs right from the get-go.
Yeah.
Amateur.
Dax, why are you so quiet?
Sorry. So, Mike, for you to get up, because it's a little more difficult for you, give me a climb roll. It's going to be a difficulty.
I have climb.
Yeah, perfect. So oh, okay.
To lower it by 1.
Perfect. So it's going to be simple. You just need a 3 or higher.
Roll 3 or higher. Come on.
I think I'm going to use effort because of the way I tend to roll, but I won't.
Okay. Let's see how it goes. Nice. So yeah, you get helped up relatively easily, and now you're standing on top of the elevator next to Sly. Effort and Dex are in the elevator, still kind of looking.
Well, boost me up so I can open the door. Try to open the door.
Okay. So I boost him.
You're going to get up as well?
What? I thought I was still in the elevator.
Yeah, you're still in the elevator. Sly and Sly and Liam are now on top, and he's boosting him up to the fifth floor.
Yeah.
Perfect. So, Liam, you don't have to do too much, and Sly, again, because you're very athletic, it's relatively easy for you to get a good grip, and you can get yourself to kind of the base of the elevator with about maybe a foot of reach towards the bottom, and you can attempt to pull it open, but it will take a bit of strength.
Okay, I have an advantage in heavy lifting. Does that help?
Sure, we'll say that will. It is going to be a demanding, so it's now going to be down to 6. 6 or higher.
All right. I will use 1 tier of effort, please.
Okay, so it's going to be simple. 3 or higher.
Okay. That would be go down to 11. And here goes my roll. Fine.
Ooh, okay, perfect. So with a bit of difficulty, you can wedge it open a certain degree. And the elevator is about this open. It doesn't seem to be retracting either. And you can, again, kind of help yourself up. If you want to help anyone else up, you can give them a boost, but it is going to be more difficult than climbing to the top of the elevator. Because, again, it's basically a boost and a half. They have to jump a bit, and you have to kind of grab them.
So is it beneficial for me to help them or no?
Definitely beneficial for you to help
them. And I will help them.
Okay. Liam. So you're now standing on top of the elevator.
Hi.
Sly is above, and he's holding a hand out. Alex, or Effort, and Dex, you guys are still in the elevator.
So I will be reaching down.
Okay.
To help pull those guys up.
Perfect. Okay, so Effort, we'll have you go. You're muted. I can't hear you.
I just forgot. Sorry. Dex is, I lift up this lifeless body of Dex.
This okay, happens in Recursions sometimes.
Oh, here he is. Reach, Dex. Reach. Stop being so limp. Oh, here we are.
Okay, so you give Dex a boost.
It's fun this way.
Dex, here we are. Oh, you're awake. Okay.
I'm awake.
I'm giving you a boost.
I'm awake the whole time.
Grab Liam's arm. He's boosting you up the shaft. Of the elevator.
We all look for cracks so we can.
Thanks for clarifying. And I pull myself up.
Perfect. So you pull yourself up relatively easy because you're actually being boosted and you are being lifted. So you actually, I'm not going to make you roll because that's basically two tiers right there. And you're now on top of the elevator with our man Liam. And Sly is up there still holding his arm out. And Effort, where are you?
I'm still in the elevator. Help me up.
All right.
So it's going to be, you're going to have to roll for it, Effort.
There we go.
You're going to have to roll for it.
Me?
Yeah. Because you're only getting one, so we'll be down to 3 or above.
13. I'm up.
So, yeah, the three of you are now on top of the elevator. And as you climb up, you put a little bit of weight on it, and the elevator actually shifts a bit.
Yeah, that's what I knew that was going to happen. I start stomping. I knew that was going to happen.
And as you're on top of the elevator, you actually see it shifted quite a bit, and the elevator actually opens, bing, from inside, and you now see the fourth floor below.
Oh.
Like, if you climb back in the elevator, it opened the fourth floor.
Ah.
Sly, new plan.
I'll meet you down there. I'm not getting down from here.
So I climb back down into the elevator.
Okay, so Effort, you climb back down. Liam and Dex?
Well, I would help Dex down.
Okay. Again, relative
to myself. Yeah.
Okay, so Liam, as you help Dex down, you hear a halt! And there is a voice coming from the fourth floor open. And Dex and Effort, as you guys are helping each other down, you see a soldier walk up with like a MP40 type gun drawn and says, "What are you doing here? Why are you doing this in the elevator? These levels are off limits."
Yeah,
you've seen us in let me speak. We are the actors here on the Führer's behalf, and we are looking to get back to our room in 312.
And he kind of gives you a look up and down.
Yeah.
What is the name of the play you are in?
It's the most popular play on the earth right now. Duh.
But what is the name of the play?
Triumph of Nazi.
You know, it's so funny. We are in it. We are acting. We know the script. We have write it. And I'm drawing a blank.
Yeah, me also. Let me see. I also draw a blank.
So I'm sinking.
If you want, you
what
can
what are you thinking about?
He's gone. You can roll to tell him that you forgot, It's going to be difficult, but you have deception as one of your abilities, so it will lower it one.
You know what's funny? We actually changed the name of the play literally last night. So it was called something, but it's now called The Grand Führer and His Rise to Power.
Yeah, yeah.
And he looks you over, and he goes between the two of you. So give me a roll. It's going to be...
And I have deception, so...
Yeah, it's going to be challenging, lower to difficult. Difficult, so you need 12 or above. Or you can lower it one tier.
Ooh, yeah, I would have lowered it one tier anyways, but...
Oh, seven. Okay. So take 3 points off, minus whatever effort you would have had, but it does not succeed. So he looks at you and says, Nine. Nine. Such play is plastered everywhere, so you did not change the name. I saw it myself, it was brilliant. But you're still not allowed to be on these levels. Come with me, both of you.
Well, if you saw it, then you know we are the actors.
Yes. It's not that you don't... It's that you don't belong here. Don't poke holes in my logic. Come with me.
No.
And he pulls you, he motions for you to get out into the hallway.
Okay. Now, does he see that they're up above the shaft?
No, he's standing out in the hallway. So Liam and Sly. Okay. Liam, you would hear this, and you probably would signal to Sly.
Oh. I thought I was dangling the whole time. That's why I had
Oh, no, hand. I had you.
You dropped.
Okay. I thought you were just putting your hands up because he had a weapon.
No, I was
dangling. Oh, that's why I had my hands up.
Yeah.
Because of you.
Well, either way, he saw both of you, and he kind of... In my mind, you had dropped, so he's not looking up, but...
Okay.
If you want, you can have it.
And how many are there?
You only see one and when you walk out.
Okay. Hmm. And, okay, all right, yeah, so I step out into the hall, and I say, I guess I have no choices.
Yeah, he says, look, you just can't be on this level. I must escort you back to your level.
But our room is on this level, or on level 3. We are trying to get there, but the elevator stopped, and we're having all these troubles.
All
right.
Wouldn't
you like to help us?
And he did like the play. Sure, so you can roll again if you'd like, and again it will be lowered a tier.
Six.
No. So he says, I would like to help you, but this is still against the Führer's rule, and I cannot go against him. Come, this way.
Alright.
Starts poking in the back. Walk, walk.
I guess we will go to our room 312.
And, yeah, he starts marching you down the hall. And Liam, you're above. What are you doing? They're now walking.
I think at this point I would try to climb up and meet Sly.
Okay, so he's helping you, so it's going to be a standard roll. So yep. If you want to give
So again, I will use my climb, and this time I will use effort just in case because I want to fall down.
Okay, so at that point it will be routine, so then you make up no problem.
Okay, beautiful.
Okay, so the two of you get up on the fifth floor, and as you pull yourselves up, you see that it's, while this claims to be a hotel, these are like offices and things like that. And this is also a hotel slash, it looks like, the Nazi HQ. So it seems rather kind of heavy as you're looking up. And the elevator is just around the corner, luckily, that you haven't been spotted just yet. But you do stand up, and you see people kind of walking around everywhere, although they look like they're dressed in regular business wear.
Now, are there any other elevators, or this is the only one?
There is another bank of elevators on the opposite side of the wall. So you can try again just to...
What do you say, Sly?
Should
we just walk right across like we belong here?
Yes, but I don't think we should take the elevator. I think we should try to look for stairs. Because I think it's going to stop us trying to get down there.
Okay. So we will walk with purpose like we belong there.
Okay. So you start... walking with purpose like you belong there. And as you do, you're trying to kind of find the stairs because you're kind of in the middle of the place and you're kind of looking around. And as you pass over, you kind of see these like ping pong ball tables that all the Germans are kind of like playing at in full uniform. And they're like kind of yelling at each other and like, nine, nine. And you actually see on the other side of it is like the stairs.
Are they saying the score is 9-9?
Yeah.
Or...
No, go to the... 9-9.
I know. I'm going to the stairs. I try to go into the stairwell.
Okay. I'm going to give you the option for an intrusion now, if you'd like.
Okay, let's hear it.
Okay, you don't get to know.
Then no.
Okay, so you continue walking forward.
Chris doesn't like surprises.
Yeah, so you keep walking forward, and you get to the stairwell relatively normal. You get a few looks at you that kind of are like, what is he doing here? But nothing enough to stop you.
We're still wearing our uniforms, aren't we, from the play?
Yeah, exactly. And Liam, you do the same thing.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Perfect. Yep. So you guys make it to the stairs. Meanwhile, effort and dex. So you guys are a little bit at gunpoint as he's kind of marching you forward. And he's behind you a good few feet. Okay. And he's kind of saying, look, I don't want to do this, but you must understand that this floor is completely off limits.
Oh, but the third floor is okay?
Of course, if you're from the third floor, that's fine, but you cannot be here.
But why is it off limits?
And he's just such a curious man. Down and he says, listen, this floor is the gym. It is only for top-level master rate suite renters. You can't be here. Not if you're on the third floor. Come, go!
Damn it. I'm going.
Right.
This is the gym I was looking for. Okay.
Okay, we go downstairs.
I turn to him and I say, keeps walking.
Yeah.
Sorry, go ahead.
As I say, I turn to him and say, okay, we're not trying to be on this floor, but the elevator stopped. We can't work it. We'll take the stairs. Please, sir, let us go. We take the stairs down.
Perfect. Now, you get to the stairway, and he says, what did you say is the number of your room was?
312?
He says, you seem unsure of yourself.
No, it was the inflection. It's 312.
Okay, so it's going to be easy, but a standard, and it'll be lowered by one. So simple, but he's doubting what you're saying.
Can I help him by going, yeah.
You can do it, and it will give a momentary distraction, but it will still be a simple. Still only three or about.
Seven.
Okay, so he says, good. Very well, I won't ask to check your key card, I believe you. And he puts it down, he says, I'm sorry to do this, but you must understand that if you let anyone into the gym areas, then what's the point of renting the master suites? It's just not his job.
And I say, you know what, because you're being such a good sport, we will do a quick improv. Look, let's do the elevator part, Dax.
Yeah, okay.
I'm the Germans playing, you are the Americans, weak Americans.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he yells, he says, Hans, Sing, Fine, come look! And immediately three doors open and like a guy another Nazi comes out, and another one leans out and says, oh, the actors! And they kind of come over to you and say, come, you must perform for us! And they start tugging you on the arm and pulling you into the to the bath that they just came out of. And they actually pull you into a locker room.
No.
You must.
It's absolutely brilliant. You're genius.
We must rest. We are actors.
And the Führer would be very upset to find we were giving free shows to the soldiers. You must attend the matinee performance tomorrow if you want to see us.
You sound like Mel Brooks doing a German accent.
That's actually who I was thinking of.
So they kind of stop, and they're like, very well. I suppose this is acceptable.
Yes. And but we very much appreciate your enthusiasm.
Yeah.
We will use that inspiration in our performance tomorrow. Yeah.
We do. We will. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. So you turn around and you make it to the stairway, and it shuts behind you.
More hesitation.
You need a key card to get in. The master suite key card. And Sly and Liam, you enter the stairwell and you hear a commotion and a slamming door a floor below you.
While we walk down and peer over to see if I can see who's there.
Yeah, because that's exactly... You look over the railing to see the floor below you.
Yeah. So, I don't know, did you guys stick your heads out to look up?
I would have, yes.
Yes. Then you both see each other.
Oh, hey!
Hurry up! I run down.
Okay, so you run down.
How'd you guys get away from them?
It wasn't easy.
No, we had to do all this fucking singing and dancing. Yeah.
They almost brought us into the bathroom.
Hmm. That would have been horrible. Can we get to the third floor?
How did you guys do?
There was ping pong. The score was 9-9.
What kind of ping pong?
I don't know. Nazi ping pong?
Oh, okay.
So we can't get into this floor without a key card. Is that what you're saying?
Fourth floor, yeah, the gym floor.
Oh, let's get to the third floor. So let's keep going.
Perfect. No hesitation.
Yeah, you head down the stairs, and you're on the third floor. And the door is a little different than the others, actually. It's like a wooden door. Everything else is kind of like heavy metal, but this seems odd. It's kind of like almost like a barn door.
Okay.
Sorry, I just picture, like, Black Sabbath. All the other doors are like heavy metal.
Wow! Yeah, bro. Put it down. Look out!
It's like a kind of a wooden, a weird door thing.
All right. Does it open?
Yeah.
All right. All right.
Okay. So
lead the way there, Sly.
So Sly, you head into it, and it seems like a more run-down version of the higher end. Room rent. It's, I mean, it's still very nice, but
it's just not for the master race.
It's just not for the. It's not the master race suite. That's right. The top notch. So you, you head in and you can see the doors are all numbered 301, 303, so on and so forth, and alternating opposite sides.
All right. Well.
Let's go to the 12th door.
Okay. So you head to 312. And there is no 312.
Oh.
It goes 310, 314, and there's just nothing there.
Is it like a Harry Potter thing where we have to do like 9 3/4? I'd try to knock out where 312 would be.
Sure.
Or,
so
like, or like being John Malkovich.
The half floor?
The half floor.
So yeah, you walk up to where the door would be, and you kind of knock, and it's just, you kind of knock in drywall. It doesn't seem like it should, sorry, I should clarify, because that might have been confusing or whatever. It doesn't look like there's a space that the door should be there. It just goes 9-10, 9-14, 9-16. Even numerically, it should be 9-12, but there's no, like...
You mean 3-3.
Sorry, 3. 9!
9-10, 9-12. I'm going to draw a picture.
Oh, good. Okay, so...
It'd be very boring.
What do we do, Sly? Do we just start saying we're with the resistance? Should we shout that?
I think that's a bad idea, Dex.
We're with the resistance in the Nazi headquarters!
We could order more sauerkraut and see what happens. Maybe we'll get some more information.
Oh, yeah, we order sauerkraut. And then follow
the bellhop.
We say it's going to 312, and then we follow it.
I like it.
I like it, too.
It's foolproof. Or foolish. One of the two.
One of the two. I don't know which. What do you think, Liam? What's on your mind?
What if we just knock on walls?
Walls?
Or doors?
Well, no, not doors.
We tried the walls.
Did you knock on them?
Well, yeah, he did, and it's nothing happened. It just seemed like it's not even really big enough for a door. It's just the number 312 just doesn't exist.
All right. I'm going to stew on this for a moment. I'm going to go into the same meditative state I did when I was observing effort for the first time. Perfect. And see if I can't crack this code.
Dex has become more thoughtful in this Nazi universe.
Yeah, he's less impulsive. Yeah.
As he just ate paper out of the...
Wait for it.
Well, that wasn't
Wait
my...
Wait for it.
Well, I'm taking
it
around.
Wait for it.
Are you guys just going to wait?
Yeah, what are you guys doing?
Yeah, for sure. I'm going to start knocking on doors.
Sure.
I'm going to start at 314.
Okay, so you knock on 314.
And I'm going to take the bottle of Jaeger with me.
Okay. So you knock on 314. And there's no answer.
This is your picture.
Nice.
To the point.
Good thing you're here.
It's more of a joke.
All right, I try 310, though.
No, that's perfect. That's exactly it. 310. Okay, so you knock on 310, and you hear some shuffling inside. And someone opens the door.
I say, I'm looking for 312.
He says, 312?
Isn't this 312? And I walk in. Like, I actually walk past him. And I spill a little bit of Jägermeister onto him.
Okay.
You have been drinking. You are drunk. You smell of Jägermeister. Is this where this is 312? I'm gonna go take a nap. But as I walk by him to go to the bed, I wanna like look at the wall to see if there's a connecting room.
Okay. So you go to walk by him and he just holds his hand and he says, No, hold on, buddy. Are you trying to push past him?
Yeah. I wanna just kinda like
force push your way in.
You have to do a bit of force to get past him. He's not a big guy, but he's stopping you.
Okay.
So give me a roll. It'll be relatively easy, but
16.
Okay. So you do push. You push past him relatively hard, actually.
Why are you doing in my room?
And he kind of spins a little bit, and he's like.
And I push him into the hall and close the door behind him.
Okay. So he's in the hallway. He's in the hallway, and he's looking at you three guys as Dex is sitting there, kind of looking, and the other two guys are kind of looking around.
And I turn to the guy with the bowl of sauerkraut, and I say, "Sauerkraut?"
You bring him
and I offer him some.
And he looks at you, and he's just kind of like in shock, I suppose, would be the best way to put it. He's kind of a thin guy with glasses, balding, and he's kind of like, What?
I said, "Sauerkraut?"
And he's like, oh. And he's wearing like a wife beater and like underwear, too, eh? And he's like, oh, and he starts just like moving while he's looking back, and he just runs towards the stairs, and in a few moments he's opened them and he runs down.
Oh, crikey.
So I'm doing observing
going
the area and trying to get a layout of it and trying to figure out what's so special about this floor. And every now and then walking down the hall and peering around corners. And
it's a pretty straight hallway for the most part. Yeah.
Okay. And look for like resistance footprints.
Okay.
Okay.
It's dead end here, the difficulty of.
Okay. You can give me a roll then, for the location kind of information about the location.
Nine.
Okay, yeah. That is just a success. So what you do realize is that there's nothing interesting about this location. It seems like a convenient or a purposeful reason that they gave you 312 and there is no 312. And part of you thinks that, oh, wait a minute, if the resistance were trying to fight back against a massive regime that occupies everywhere, to put it visibly in a bowl of sauerkraut and not sort of have a secret message written on the white paper might be really, really dumb. So it seems to you like, oh, wait a minute, that might have been a decoy, and there's something else might be on the paper that's hidden.
So I think we should take Gabe's advice.
But you ate a piece of it, FYI.
I am brilliant.
All right, I think we should take Gabe's advice and have Liam reach into your throat, Dex.
Yeah. And
make you vomit up the piece of paper.
I won't lie. It's already been about 30, 40 minutes. It's probably
And you know what? After that much sauerkraut, you probably wouldn't need to reach into his throat.
I didn't even feel like sauerkraut. It was like the hand of God made me start to eat the sauerkraut.
Exactly.
And I wasn't even planning on it, you know? It was just weird. I say, that's narrator, did you have something to do with that?
The narrator did.
Damn narrator. Okay, well, let's look at this piece of paper. Maybe we can still piece it together.
All right.
Yeah, so like I said, the front of the piece of paper says the resistance needs you. It says proceed immediately to room 312. But again, it only looks like 3. The other side is blank. At least it looks blank.
Maybe anything in this room, or can I join them again?
You're in the room, yeah. Well, you're walking around, and there's like some like open bottles of alcohol. This guy kind of looks a bit sad.
So, is there any lemon?
There is in the room.
Yeah.
Maybe
for like water or for
like on the side of the glasses.
I feel like there'd be enough acidity in the sauerkraut that I was in, so that you just need some heat now at this point. If you're looking for secret messages.
Yeah, that's...
So hold it up to the lamp, or the light. But I'm in the room.
Are you in the room? I was going to say, like, are you coming up and being like, hey, the thing I don't know about, hold up to the light.
No, I would come out and say there's no secret door in there. So.
Well, you are looking around the room, and you do find this guy. You're kind of rooting through this guy's possessions. Where are you? I don't know. What are you doing?
I was just looking for, like, an extra, like, a door that I would lead.
Okay, so, no, you touch the door. You don't really look at anything else in the room. And no. There doesn't seem to be anything on the wall.
I look for ciphers, and I touch the door. That's the two things I do.
You look for ciphers and you touch the door.
Okay. No, nothing there. Okay, then I go back to the guys.
Okay, so you head out, and Justin, or Dex, is standing, being like, Eureka!
Piece of paper. So, there might be a secret message on it, but I don't know why I just thought of that now.
Because you stewed on it. Because there's no 312.
Stewing. Now, it's too bad that somebody, and I look at Liam, took a bite out of this.
Liam,
but I think we could still figure it out. And I start looking at it. Now, okay, can I do just a regular intellect roll on it?
No. I mean, you can't. I mean, you could, but you can't see anything on it. It needs some sort of activation of some sort.
Have you seen anything like this before, Effort? In your travels as a detective man?
A missing agency? Door?
No, a note. This note might have a secret message on it. Well, my thing...
Let me just take a quick look here.
What are you looking at?
My character sheet.
You must know if he has anything.
No, in fact, my inability is that I'm not very knowledgeable.
How did you become an agent?
Or retaining things, tasks involving lore, knowledge, understanding.
I think he deceived his way in, Sly. Which is why I think we could trust him.
I'm not an idiot. I'm not wise in the ways of lore. So, no, I don't know. But you know what? I'm going to knock on 314 and do the same thing.
There was no answer at 314.
Yeah. Sly. Oh, there wasn't.
Maybe if we knock on the door.
Alright, so why don't you try...
Hold it up to the light.
Yeah.
The
light thing.
Okay, so you hold it up to the light, and you can't really see anything, but as you get a little closer, you do kind of make out... The heat from the light is kind of imprinting something on the other side of it.
Get out a lighter!
But you can hold it there for a few minutes, and it will...
Yeah.
And right in the center of the page, on the blank side, not the part you ate, so don't worry, the narrative is green, is very cleanly written 204.
Oh,
and as you see this, you scream Eureka, you hear a series of footsteps, and the hallway at the end open up, and you see a Nazi there with an MP4. And he says, "Huh!"
And we all jump into character and start acting and running in the opposite direction.
No, I start singing Edelweiss.
Edelweiss. So
and slowly walking down the hall, and when you start singing, he stops.
You look, start thinking of something
new. And he's looking mad that you, like,
Edelweiss, tall and strong. We look happy to see you.
And you can see he's, like, trying to inch forward as you're singing it.
Schmucke das Heimatlandglut und Weiß.
As we're singing, we're walking backwards slowly to the other end of the hallway.
Okay. So he's moving slowly, and you can see now that two more are stepping through slowly as you're singing Edelweiss.
It's like a slow race.
Yeah. Well, you're going faster than them because you don't care about the song. And you get to the back, and you can feel the wooden door behind you.
Huh? Oh, back the end of the hall. Yeah.
Stairwell. Oh, I open it up, and I say. Edelweisses are ugly flowers, and I close the door behind it.
Run!
Okay.
I don't know why I did that. I'm brash.
I'm going to offer a GM intrusion.
Yep.
Do you want to take it?
Yes, I do this time.
Okay. You go to open the door, you yell it, and you open it, and there's another Nazi right there who's been standing listening to you through the
is
door.
What those guys said.
Nice.
So you give the XP and give it to somebody else.
I will give the XP to Dex.
Okay. So he's standing there, and he's just looking at you like... And your song is just about to finish.
Right. And I take his gun while his one hand's on the... His heart?
My.
Oh, you take his gun?
Can I?
Well, you still got a free hand. Well, you can try, but that's going to end really bad.
Is that?
I'm just going to tell you.
Why?
Well, okay, go for it.
Might it work? It could work.
Try. Yeah, you could grab his gun. Yes.
He's got one hand, and I got two hands, right?
Yes.
So I have an advantage.
I'm not saying that you couldn't do it. I'm not saying grabbing it. The physical act of grabbing it would end bad. I'm saying being in Nazi headquarters after stealing a Nazi's gun would end really bad.
Yeah, Sly.
Fair enough.
I see you. What you're thinking.
I'm just saying, think long term. You're not going to get out of Nazi headquarters.
It's too late. I already tried. I already did it. Like, the hindsight is 20/20.
You tried to snatch it already?
Well, I said I did it. I can't be like...
Yeah, but you didn't roll.
So?
Well, if you want to do it, you can do it. There's nothing against it.
Dex is for it.
Okay. Yeah, I'll give it a try.
A life of adventure.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
Okay. Meanwhile, I slip past and I'm walking down the stairs.
11.
Okay, so...
With an advantage.
Why an advantage?
Because he's got one hand, I got two.
Okay, yes. So really, it would be your speed versus, I guess, his speed. Just and level, right? How do you roll against... it would only be if you succeeded in a speed roll. And against his level, which is level 5. So you would be...
Against level 4, so it's to fail.
You need 15, so 12, so no.
I'll
use
an XP point to roll again.
Okay.
Oh, shite.
And this time, I'll use effort, which I have to do.
I don't think you can use effort if you spend an XP to reroll. I don't think you can alter it at that point.
I think you have to use effort on your second roll.
No. If you're spending an XP point to reroll, that's totally fine. But I don't think you can alter that second roll to be more
beneficial. Fair enough. There goes nothing. Mm-hmm. Less successful.
Okay, so you go for his gun, and he doesn't give it to you, and he sees you grab him around, and he grabs his gun, and.
And as I say, and as that
he's
happens,
he's about to shoot you in the head.
You're over to Sly, and I say, "The Americans, they tried their hardest to take the power from us, but they could not, as you successfully demonstrated. What is your name, soldier?"
Okay. So he's like really confused, but he's like,
"I'm also confused."
He's like, "Oh, you know the actors?"
Yeah,
it's going to be a very difficult, I'm going to say intimidating bluff that you're trying to do right now. That's 18.
Intimidating bluff.
Or intimidating, whatever you want to call it.
All right, so let's try to figure out some assets. First of all, I'm strange, so that's going to be even more difficult.
That's also, well, yeah, that's true. So you're at 21. You have to beat 21.
All right, I'll use effort.
Okay, so that's back down to 18.
All right.
I immediately go into my pose that I hope he recognizes from the beginning.
You know what? If you all go into your poses based on the fact that you picked it up, which I would say you will, I will lower it another tier. Because yeah. I think that was a very clever use of it.
Okay.
Do you remember us?
Yeah. It's a stretch, but let's do it. So, right. Is there anything else you can do to lower it?
I used effort, so it's down a tier. The poses is helping, so that's down a tier.
It's at 15 right now because it went up to 21 based on your strangeness. It went back down to 18 based on what you did, and then 15 for the poses.
All right. So then I'm just gonna roll.
All right, and you can spend XP to reroll if you totally botch it.
I'm going to do that. Thanks for that XP earlier. Sly, maybe it'll... seven again.
Whoa! Okay. So he doesn't buy it.
That's because it came from the wrong actor!
Let him shoot, because he still has to shoot at me, Harlan.
No, no, he draws the gun on you, but I think that was a very clever decoy, because his brashness was then put off. I'm not going to say he doesn't put it away, but I think that alone was clever enough to halt him in his tracks. And what you have bought is a single action. That's what I will say. He does look like he's about to fire at you, but you've kind of gained his interest for a moment. He hasn't been like, oh yeah, they're just acting. He's like, just utterly confused for a moment, and he's kind of looking at each of you.
Put your finger in the barrel.
Can we? Yeah, do that, and then we start doing like a Three Stooges type slapstick comedy. And then like the three of us, you know, running around.
In if circles. All four of you give it your all right now, I will give you a bonus. I'll just lower one tier. Go. Excellent. So he is utterly flabbergasted, and I will tell you this: he doesn't put his weapon away, but he lowers it because he can't kill you if you're insane.
Yeah, those Nazis, they were really understanding.
Well, he's a second generation Nazi. Yeah. So he lowers it a bit, and he looks at you, Effort, because you're kind of the one who conducted it, and he just kind of waits for you to say something.
Just bow. I bow.
Effort?
Just bow.
Yes, okay. Good idea.
So
we'll return to our wombs.
So roll a deceive, and it will be only difficult this time. So a score of 12 that you'll need to beat.
Should I roll? I got a good deception.
Yeah, he's looking at you.
Okay, so I'll apply effort as well.
So that'll bring it down to 6.
And I'll say, we must return to our room for proper rest of an actor. Good night.
So to reiterate my heels. Transpired. These Nazis started running at you, and you decided to sing Edelweiss, which stopped them in their tracks. They, with the MP40 at the far end, and two others, so three of them came in, and they're kind of walking towards you very slowly as you backed up. Sly, as you open the door, you scream, Edelweiss is a gay song or something. What did you
say? Edelweiss is the ugliest flower.
Ugliest flower. To turn around and find another Nazi right in your face, who like looked really angry at you, but he was also still singing. You decided to go for his gun, but you missed. He then reacted by grabbing his gun in utter furiousness before Dex jumped in and went, and that's what would happen if the Americans tried to grab your weapon, which you successfully defeated, which just kind of stopped him. At which point, you all started going, whoop, 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 for like a good minute, and then bowed. And he just went, oh. And now you're all kind of walking around him?
We're now going down to the second floor.
Yeah. Good night.
Guten Tag. Guten Tagen.
Meine Leben.
Well done for all that. Because that was just so a very long farewell. So you guys all, and the ones behind you just stopped as well, and they're like, we don't get New York humor. It's just so out there. Woody Allen and all this. So you guys walked in, and you kind of walk past, just with the guy kind of in awe. As you're walking down the stairs, you see him putting his gun back in the holster. And you successfully make it to the second floor, some fucking how. Okay, so yeah, you make it to the second floor, you open it up, and you see the daunted doors. You see 204 standing in all of its glory.
Oh. Well, I'm kind of tired, guys. Why don't
let's go back up to our room.
Go back to
the room. I like the third floor. That place is happening.
It is 5:30.
So. Wooden doors.
It's 5:30?
Yeah.
In the morning.
It's a long time. No, at night. You have dinner at 6, remember?
Oh.
Yeah, but we weren't going.
Well, yeah, I mean, we have canceled. someone else has dinner. Well, whatever.
Anyway. Well, we imagine they go for dinner for a while. So.
All right.
After.
Yeah. Let's go. Knock on 204.
So you knock on the door, and you hear a voice.
What's the password?
Invictus?
What? No, what's the password?
1, 2, 3, 4.
No, that's not it. What's the password? What do you mean?
312.
I can't give them multiple. What's the password? You have like, I don't know, two more tries?
I'm going to try a deception here.
Okay.
I'm going to say the password is... I don't know. 1, 2, 3, 4, open the door. 11.
Okay.
You're deceiving him.
So you say that, and he goes, no. Are you here for the resistance?
Yeah, we're here for the resistance.
Sauerkraut.
Okay, hold on 1 second. No, these guys didn't get the password, but they say they're here for the resistance. Yeah? Okay. Okay, cool.
Show them the paper. Show them the paper.
Are you guys cool though? Like, are you cool?
Well, yeah, we're pretty most cool. Mostly, yeah. Yeah.
No, so but far like, I'm not feeling okay, a lot but of like, faith if in I resistance. Asked
you, no, yeah. But if I ask you, you gotta tell me, are you like Nazis?
Do we sound like Nazis to you?
You have to tell me. That's like part of it.
Fine.
Oh, yeah. Hunter Olson.
What? That's the password. That's the
Hunter
password.
Olson.
Yeah, you're good.
So the outside opens up, and this really guy with like long hair, kind of looks like a hippie, is like, "Hey, come on in." I was like worried there for a second that you didn't know the password, but then you totally did, man. How did you know Hunter Olson was the password? That's like two random things I was just thinking about. I didn't even say it to anybody. Come on in. And he shuts the door behind you. And there's a guy sitting at like a small round table, and there's only two of them in the room. And the guy at the round table is just kind of like holding his head. He's like, oh my god. He says, you're the actors, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Look, I got a level with you. I'm part of the resistance. And we have a strong uprising here in New York City. And we think we can take back this country. But it all starts the Fuhrer. No one's been up to that floor. We can't get any operatives up there. But we're convinced that if someone can take him out, the whole thing will crumble. Everything seems to be riding on his shoulders. If someone can kill the Fuhrer and prove that he's dead in some way, I think we can break this thing wide open.
Let's kill Hitler!
That's the spirit I like.
Just as long as they're not up against a Mecha Hitler.
Oh, whoa.
No, Mecha Hitler died out 5 years ago. This is just regular Hitler. I'm just kidding. There's no such thing. What are you joking?
Is it Brad Pitt? Is that who's got the long hair?
This is Brad Pitt, yeah. Actually, you guys know him as Brad Pitt the actor, but now, because of an alternate timeline, he's just a regular guy. But it is actually Brad Pitt.
Cool. Cool. Here you go, Gabe. Brad Pitt finally arrives.
He's like, how'd you know my name?
Brad... It's me. I'm just fucking with you. Listen, we are gonna try and get to the Fuhrer, but you know what's your resistance like? How strong are you guys?
We have a lot of people, including some that are working still for the Nazis, waiting for the Fuhrer to fall. Because everyone does what he says. The minute he's dead, the minute we can parade his body around, we have an uprising on our hands. Gentlemen, we can take back New York City. I don't have to keep trying to bring resistance fighters in from the Midwest. I don't have to keep buying resistance fighters from bounty hunters all over the country.
What kind of death would make the biggest impact to the Nazis? If we threw him off the top,
throw that asshole from his ivory tower, if you throw him through that plate glass window, that giant swastika that he has at the top of the building, which is in his office, I think that'll make a pretty goddamn good mark.
All right, so why haven't you guys done that yet?
We can't get up there. Every time we try to move up there, it's done. We've lost many Bothans, which is the name of the family that...
Bothans?
Yeah, George Bothan, Michael Bothan.
Matt Bothan, girls?
Matt Bothan, Billy Bothan. They're the Bothan family.
Fat Botham girls.
We've lost. Look, you have resistance fighters, but a lot of them still have ties to the Nazi regime, or they're worried about their families. I've been taking harsh measures to try to find people to fight for the resistance, fight for this cause, without having any ties, and I've had to turn to some things I would rather not have had to.
How much money do you spend on sauerkraut for recruiting?
First off, sauerkraut is from one of the guys I have in the kitchens. He just opens a tin, okay? Oh. It's not tough. Second, sauerkraut's actually delicious. I gotta say, that's the one thing that the Nazis did right. My God, I gotta say, a freaking sauerkraut sandwich, oh, nothing better. Honestly,
necessarily
nothing.
A Nazi thing?
Guys, kill Hitler, try the sauerkraut. It's so good.
Oh, I tried it. I tried it.
It's good, right?
Really good. Really good.
Tell me, while we're here, and before we leave you to go kill the Führer, do you know of a man that we're looking to help our resistance? His name is Crax.
And his eyes light up. How do you know that name?
We were told that he could help us.
Crax is the gentleman that I've been buying soldiers from. En masse. He's been aiding my resistance fighters when they go down. He's the one I've been getting tireless resistance fighters, men willing to fight.
I'll tell you what, if we kill the Führer for you and help the resistance, will you help me and put me in touch with Crax?
I'll do you one better. I'll tell you where he is. He's still in the city. He's leaving today. But I know exactly where he is.
Where's he leaving to?
I don't know. He pops in and pops out. I never seem to be able to pin him down, but he comes around every few months, offering to refill my supplies with soldiers. Look, in this world, I don't ask questions. He came to me one day in a bar, told me his name is Crack, said that he has people at his disposal willing to fight without families, without any ties. They'll come in, they'll fight for me, and they'll die for me.
What are his...
Between that and the people being murdered in the streets, I took it.
What are his soldiers like? Are they dependable?
To be honest, and he kind of thinks he's sharing too much for a moment. He goes, actually, you know what? It's not worth talking about.
No, tell me. I'm interested. I want to know if he's supplying you with good quality soldiers, because that's kind of why we're here, to help supply you with good quality soldiers.
Effort, I think it's enough for him to tell us where to meet him tonight, don't you think?
And he turns back and says, look, the soldiers that he brings to me at first seem a little distant. I usually need to catch them up to speed with what's going on. I don't know what he does with them or where he brings them from, but they're able-bodied men and women. They're all different ages, and they have what seems like no history. They don't know anything. They're blank slates. They have no ties, but... they get this world, and once I explain to them, they're ready, able fighters. I don't really know where he gets them from, to be honest, and it's part of something I'm ashamed. But if we can beat Hitler and bring down the regime, we can be free again as people.
Well, let's do this. We'll be on board. We'll go kill the Führer. You'll get us to meet Zach. Crax. And when we're done that, when we're free... you, sir, get into the movies.
Well,
you're a beautiful, beautiful human being.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. It's like one of those things. I can't really do a Brad Pitt impression. Listen.
You have to be eating.
Listen, it's going to be okay.
Yeah, anyway, movies, great. So we're going to go up and take down the Führer of Nazi America, who is the leader of this entire...
Actually, we don't call it America anymore. It's now East Germany.
Okay.
Sorry, West Germany.
West Germany.
Oh, yeah. Right, yes. Okay. So West Germany, so we're going to take down the leader, the four of us, four actors. are you, is there anything that you can give us that will help us out in this?
Listen, I get that the odds are against you.
A little against us.
But you got to understand that nobody has even been up to that floor in years, and yet you are famous enough that he got you up there.
Okay, all right, yes, I know, I understand that, but look at what I'm holding right now, my bare hands. Okay, I can get up there, but what am I supposed to do when I run into his guard?
You got weapons. Yeah, I got weapons.
Yeah, thank you. I want weapons.
I got three weapons right here for you guys.
But there's only three rules.
But there's only three rules. Wait a minute. You didn't do that like an Englishman. You're a German. So he opens a blanket, and there's actually five. And he goes, oh, sorry, there's five. And they're all little trinkets, different ciphers and things like that. So we got a few different random ones. We got the who's going first?
There's three or four of them.
There's five here, actually.
Five.
Yeah. I say Liam goes first. Liam, take your pick.
Absolutely. What do we got?
Okay, so you grab one that looks like a.
I don't want to grab these here. That.
You grab this one. The Call of Cthulhu. It's a fleshy-looking appliance that someone can place over their nose and mouth, and when utilized, can emit a horrifying sound. Excellent. So you can't quite. I mean, realistically, you should be rolling on these ciphers, but for sake of time, we're going to say that you spent a little bit looking at them. So Liam, you went. Justin or Dex, you get this. Oh, hold on, I need to space this out. You get the Book of Actuality. This book gives the user the power to contradict anything or anyone says or states.
Actually, it's the Book of Actuality.
Sorry, actually.
Actually, it is.
My bad.
Then we got Chris.
Hmm?
Chris, you reach in to the weird bag, and you pull out a machete. There's an actor's name on it, Danny Trejo. And you recognize him as the guy who plays Machete. And it's autographed by him, and no matter what or where you hit or how hard you hit the target, an excessive amount of blood always shoots out of the wound. Attack. I'm pretty sure that's a heavy weapon. Yeah. And then we got Effort. You reach in, and you pull out something that kind of makes you uncomfortable at first. It says Dick Puncher on it. And it's made for the child and all of us. It's made from rich Corinthian leather and the finest steel and
Damascus steel.
Only undead killing tool you will ever
That's
want
all it says. So it's just a dick puncher, I guess. So it's just like you can visualize it however you want.
I'm guessing that it's like something that would like punch a dick.
Oh. All right, and there's one more sitting on the thing, and Brad Pitt bends over and he picks it up and says, this one. This one's a little weird one. I actually bought this from Crax himself. He said it was really useful, but if you guys are taking down the Fuhrer, I think it's probably a good time to give it away. Who needs this?
Well,
give it all death.
You raised your hand first. Well done. And he hands it to you. And it is the Talking Dead, a dried-out ear belonging to a now-deceased school teacher. Oh, this is the one we couldn't read. Quickly acquired skills in seven languages was safer than in our brains. When Rose failed to do so, walking among the zombies, Rose picked up the lingo before meeting her. If the player stretches her ear around their own, they will be able to understand zombies and listen to their plans.
That'll be useful.
Let's hope someone's
zombies,
a zombie.
Dead things? Dead things?
We're going to say zombies.
Remember the bugs? Yeah.
So, Brad Pitt says, all right, look, you need to go. I don't know how you want to do
bugs.
It.
That was awesome.
There's always a guard station there, and during the night, there's usually the secretary. She works till about 8. The minute she leaves, the guard comes on, and Oscar, the general, his left-hand man, is always hovering around there. His office is right next door. You deal with them, and you got yourself a way in.
Hey, man, but we got to, like, kill a couple hours here because she doesn't leave till 8.
She doesn't normally till 8, yeah. I don't know what you want.
Except
tonight. She's leaving for dinner.
Oh, right. At 6. And look at the time. It's 6.
No, it's 6:15.
Oh, fuck. Let's go.
So you guys leave apartment 204, and as you exit the hallway, it seems quiet. Quieter than even the most quiet of hallways.
Does anybody want this zombie earpiece? I don't want it. When are we going to run into zombies?
You never know.
It's so specific.
Just hang on to it, just in case.
That's not the cipher creator's fault. That's the person who picked the theme's fault.
Oh, whatever.
So, you, no, so you,
Chris.
You head to the hallway. Or you head upstairs? Or the elevator?
Does the dick puncher have any alternative uses?
Like stun mode?
Like a puller?
There's two uses to the dick puncher. It can either punch a dick, or it can be attached on your dick to punch other things.
Okay.
See? Dick puncher or punch dicker.
All right. I hope the Fuhrer is like a 300-pound...
Elevator or stairs?
I want to use to see how sharp the machete is, but nick my finger just the tiniest bit. And see how much blood gushes out of it.
Okay, so you do. It's like, psst, and you're like,
ah! I cork it. I'm like, oh. Oh, no.
Okay. You suffer one damage.
Ones, right?
And I have 1d6 encounters, so that's one of them.
Perfect. Oh, nice.
I got 3 more encounters. It was
and
worth
you
it.
Take the damage.
I think the stairs are more reliable, guys.
But it's 30 flights.
30 flights? It's on the 5th floor, isn't it?
No, he's on the top of a 30-story building.
Oh.
Montage, well, we do it.
Shall we take the elevator?
It's like Ghostbusters.
Gonna do a montage.
How many more do we have? So you guys are walking upstairs?
Miss every scene.
Dan. So you do. You like have a montage where you walk in and talking.
Dan. Oh.
Dan. So by like 7 o'clock, Dan. You get up there. And when you get to the top floor, the door is before you. You just kick it open like this is the hallway, the stairway door.
Yeah, because we have all our weapons out too. I have a machete. Okay. I'm gonna put that.
So you kick it open.
We're here to see the Fuhrer.
And it's all empty.
Oh, nice.
There's no one there.
Perfect.
It's a good thing we didn't have to climb any Fuhrer.
Oh, further. It's quiet. A little too quiet. It's Raph. A little too Raph. It might be funnier than crickets. Anyway, so you get out there, and there's just massive double doors of the...
The Fuhrer's office? I think we should do this. We knock and say that there's a sauerkraut delivery.
I say we just walk in.
I can't be wrong.
I like the sauerkraut delivery. That sounds like a good delivery.
The Fuhrer would never come to the door.
He wouldn't come for sauerkraut.
Just say it's Oscar, and we'll walk in.
Is there like a feeding door? Is there like a feeding flap? I observed the door.
Feeding flap.
No, there's no feeding flap.
Yeah, there was just a little door that he went in or something, right?
Let's go into the second door, see if it's open.
There's a trump
feeding flap. So you go to touch the door, and there's nothing. It's locked.
So we go to the desk and see if there's a switch on the desk where Helga works.
Okay, so Liam, give me a search on the desk, and Dex, what's your idea?
Oh, I've got a knob.
Oh, what does that do?
It opens a door.
Stop just right.
You know what, Liam? There's no key. there actually isn't. You look everywhere, and there's not. You don't have to roll. It would just be a time.
So I've got a cipher that opens anything that resembles a door.
Interesting. You know, I didn't even plan for that, but the fact that you have it actually is very interesting. I totally forgot about that one.
Yeah,
there's nothing you can see. There isn't even a keyhole in the door. And Liam, you check all over the desk, and there's no button that unlocks it. There's no key hidden in the desk. Interesting. Okay, so yeah.
So yeah, I attach the knob.
It's actually like the door, I don't know what it is, but in my mind, it's like actually living. It's like,
oh yeah.
And it just like sucks on the doorknob and like goes and then it opens the door and it dies.
It's weird that I kept that in my pocket for so long.
Well, I think ciphers change their look depending on what recursion you're in.
Oh, yeah.
For some weird reason, in this recursion, it's living.
Nice. Okay, so...
Okay, so I'm going to have... Because you, Dex, you went in first?
Yeah.
Roll a 1d6.
I will do so. Burr, 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 burr. One.
Okay.
You opened the door.
So you open the door.
And there is one Donald Trump Fuhrer there.
No.
Oh,
and
that's
a the entire...
Which explains why I was writing it right on.
It's very dark. And you see the silhouette of a desk and a high back chair, and you see the massive stained glass window with the swastika and books as high as the ceiling, which is massive, but it's all dark. And the only light is leaking in from the window outside, which is now sun, almost setting sun, and the light pouring in from the hallway. And as you step in, it's very quiet.
Are we in the Empire State Building?
You were, is sort of. It's not anymore. It's not what it's called now.
Oh, the
it's Nazi, called the Empire State
Empire
Building.
Empire Nazi Building?
The Nazi Empire State Building.
The Nazi Empire State Building.
So you enter, and it's massively dark. Again, everything I just described.
Sweet.
Cool.
After cool. You fly, after you.
All right, I go in as well.
Okay.
And I literally run at the guy going, ah!
Okay, so you start running at the desk.
Whatever's there, yeah.
Okay, so as you're running, it's dark, but you can kind of see there's a desk and there's a high back chair which starts turning around as you're running at it.
Right.
And you just run at it like that and stand there with your chest exposed?
Oh, definitely. As soon as it turns around, I'm just going to cut it, whatever it is.
So it starts
turning a child.
It starts turning around.
Yeah.
So you just wait?
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay. So you let him in go first.
My character is brash. We've got to remember.
That's my character. And you hear a stabbing sound. Blood goes everywhere. And you hear a dog yelping.
Oh, no.
Slice it.
You killed a dog. You
and
killed
the
a
lights,
dog.
The lights... well, no, I guess it's still dark. You're just hacking away. And blood's just spraying everywhere. As you're just hacking this dog,
it's like this. It's like The Shining. There's just blood, like coming.
I'm flexing at myself in the mirror, looking over it.
Within the darkness, you just kind of see the silhouette of this animal. It looks.
Bob
like
says,
it
"What
Bob
was that? The Fuhrer? I don't really know what a Fuhrer is. I'm pretty sure I killed it though. Was that
so you guys see this, and you just kind of stand in the doorway.
I. Man, sly, whoa.
You know, my adrenaline is pumping. I don't know what happened.
If the dog was the Fuhrer, that would make a lot of sense.
Oh, yeah. But now, okay, so it's just a dog.
Because it's like, in dog so we trust.
I step up to Sly, and I put my hand on his shoulder.
Your logic is so weird. Because it's in dog we trust, so
it's like not opposite the fur. It's a fur.
Ah, the fur.
The fur. Female dog.
The fur. All
right. Is there anything else in the room besides a lot of blood and puppy meat?
No, there's a dog bowl in the corner, and that's about it. There's like crayons in the thing, in the desk. You can see like it's mangled. Cut off hand has like a weird little band on it where it looks like someone might put a crayon to like draw with it so that it could actually sign things, but other than that, that's it.
So that was him.
Okay, so
I'm flattered
that the dog liked our performance.
Here's something Bob posted. Hold on, I gotta share this. This is
the dog.
The fur.
It's dead.
All right, I look for the swastika and I break the window with it.
Okay, so you push. It's a heavy window.
Yeah.
So like you need something to be thrown at it or something.
Right.
Like a wheeling chair,
like a desk, because I can lift things really well in this world.
The wheeling chair would work. The desk is no. It's like a massive desk, like comically.
Okay.
But the wheeling chair would work.
Sure.
So you take the mangled dog that you've chopped to bits and the machete which I'm going to say is spent because I don't really know how many uses we're supposed to get, but I'm going to say you it's embedded in the chair. And you turn around the chair and you just push it through the window, and in a smash of glass, the chair and the German Shepherd, which was a German Shepherd, fall to the ground and just splat. And you hear the echoes of screams from like 30 floors below, but it's
quiet. Do this and I say, done. Let's go for it.
There's an awkward silence.
And I enter the room and I turn on the light switch.
Yeah. And okay, and you see massive portraits of like Hitler with a dog, with this dog that you don't really know what it looked like, to be honest. It was very dark. And yeah, everything else is very barren in the office. Like, it seems very, very odd. Bizarre.
A lot of blood.
So I think after a moment of silence and the wind whistling in through the broken window, I go up to Hey, Sly, that was pretty big what you did just there.
Thank you.
That was pretty big. So what do you think people are gonna say when they see a dog?
Was the leader of the non-free world.
Because he didn't really look like...
So as you're standing there, you hear, Huskuckle! And behind you, you see Oscar with his Luger drawn at the door, and he says, the actors! What have you done? And he holsters it, and he runs over to the desk, and he's like, no!
Shouldn't you be at dinner?
Yes, until everyone started screaming! Because there was a dead dog and I took the super elevator up.
The super elevator?
Well, let's just say you talked really slow. He says, what have you done? And he just crumples over on the desk.
So, and I say, how is Helga?
Yeah, how is Helga?
How's Helga?
She's mortified since the dog is dead.
Why are you so concerned about the dog?
Because Oscar? He was the only one we were following orders from.
Okay,
don't you understand? 3 years ago, Hitler killed himself. He shot himself in the head. He was a crazy man. He was fucking insane. But no one knew what to do. No one wanted fucking to step insane. Up. We didn't know how to function things. We thought we could start working through the kinks. You know, we have healthcare now. It's free. It's fantastic. We didn't know what to do, so... In a moment of desperation, we made his dog fear her, and we locked it away and said that Hitler was totally fine and that nothing was wrong with him. But we knew the truth.
In dog we trust. In dog we trust.
Well, Oscar, that's a that's a pretty sad story. So what are you going to do now that your Fuhrer dog is dead?
But I suppose we will just go on. I suppose the spirit of Hitler is enough.
No.
In fact, you broke the shackles that made us so dependent on him. You're right.
Sly! Now!
I start hacking him, too.
You pushed your machete out the window.
No, I didn't.
Oh, yeah.
Just push him out. So I turn and I dick punch him.
Nice. Effort.
Okay.
Because he's not expecting it, I'll say
yes. Nice strenuous exertion effort.
I give a pelvic thrust on top of the dick punch.
Okay.
Aiming at the window.
Yeah, no. So you try it. It's a good try, but you don't quite do it, and he kind of steps back.
I'm almost really angry. He's more just kind of
crumbled. I think he's trying to process. He seems very, what's the word? Malleable at this point.
Oscar, poor Oscar. I hate to break it to you, but it's over. The Nazi reigning regime. It's done. The Fuhrer was dead 3 years ago. How long did you think that this dog charade was going to act, Oscar?
Well, his notes fooled everyone else.
Not us, Oscar.
It's time to move on.
Back to Germany. Give up on the West.
And as he's crumbled, Brad Pitt enters the room. with a guy behind him, his Luger drawn, because he would have a German Luger as well. And he says, why the fuck did you throw a dog at the window?
How'd you get up here?
Express elevator.
Everyone's on the street figuring out what the hell's going on with the dog.
Ah, well, welcome to the party. This here is Oscar, and he tells us that the Fuhrer's been dead for 3 years now.
And Oscar looks up to Brad Pitt and says, Heil Hitler. Oh, am I joking? Heil no one. And Brad Pitt kind of walks over and he says,
here's a puppy.
What do you mean Hitler's been dead for 3 years?
They've replaced Hitler with his dog and have been charading him as the Fuhrer for the past 3 years. They trained him to do notes. It's actually quite impressive.
Yeah.
No, look. We didn't. I just grabbed his hand and I signed it myself. It was really, it was quite useless and it really just didn't make any sense. So Oscar's in pieces and Brad Pitt kind of looks at you guys and says, yeah, you guys did a good job, eh?
Thanks, says, Brad Pitt.
You did well. I think we can iron out this. We got enough guys out there that heard the crash, didn't see the body, but they started fighting. I think we're going to be okay now.
And I put on my parachute and I jump out the window.
You don't have a parachute just yet.
Aww,
you get that in level 3. So he looks at you and he says, so, Crax, you want to speak to this guy, yeah?
Yeah.
Well, I put in a call and I told him to meet you. He said you were looking for him. He's going to meet you downstairs at the hotel bar.
No, he won't.
What do you mean, no, he won't?
You let him know we were after him. Now he'll be gone. But we'll try to go see him, see what happens. What did you tell him exactly? You said three guys or four guys were looking for him?
Yeah, I said four guys were looking for him. One asked him by a name.
Yeah, he's not going to be there. Thanks, Brad.
Hey,
guy.
Hey.
You know, you'd probably be better as an actor than you would be as a leader of a revolution.
God. Hey. So you step over Oscar, who's crying, and Brad Pitt, who's kind of pacing around the room, and you exit the hall, and you hear a gunshot, and...
I think Gabe's in love with Brad Pitt.
Who isn't?
Ask Gabe if he's Brad. Brad, are you married?
No, with Heinrich Blad Schmidt Jolie. I don't know what that is. Anyway, so you guys head back to the elevator, and you can hear like fighting on all floors or you want to take the stairs?
No, everyone's taking the elevator, so let's try the elevator for a change.
Yeah,
well, the elevator.
A super fast elevator.
And it goes down to 10th floor and opens up. Bing! And you see everyone fighting. And it actually mirrors the last game when you were in the computer, which, by the way, was a giant computer. And you see everyone, like, fighting and, like, freaking out. It's, like, the same thing. And you're like, huh. And it shuts again, and then it goes right down to the lobby. And it opens up, and the lobby has a beautiful counter, and there's a barman kind of cleaning it. Some people are drinking, but the streets are just littered with fires and people yelling through a large glass window on the far side of the room. And you're kind of like, oh. And there's an older man leaning on the bar, a real scruffy man with a beard. And he is kind of eyeing around suspiciously.
I look at Sly, and I'm like,
Maybe he is here. Get him.
And so I walk up, and I put my hand on his shoulder.
Yeah. What do you need?
And I say, Crax, is it?
Who's asking?
You're under arrest. And I show him my estate badge.
And he kind of looks at you, and he looks at the three of you, and he smiles. He says, nah, they're after you. And he turns, and there's a man in a cloak standing in the corner. And he kind of nods a thank you to the man at the bar. And you see him throw something down, and a large gate opens. A green light fills the bar. And he jumps through.
And I run and dive into the gate after him.
Okay. What about you guys?
Is this still open?
It's still open momentarily, yeah.
Yeah, well, sure. Let's run and dive.
Okay, so you go running as fast as you can into the gate. And you dive into it, and you're torn into a million little pieces, different than how you felt when you translated, because you still feel your skin and your body. Similar to when you went into the computer, you can feel your physical formation staying the same, just rearranging in a million different ways. And like a curse of electricity soaring through your body, you can feel it surging back together as it pieces back together, and you can feel yourself falling. And with a smack, you land on a really soft substance. And the three of you kind of pop in all knocking next to each other, and you open your eyes and you hear the... He's right there! You see him standing, him lying next to you, and the four of you are standing, are lying in the back of what feels to be like a cart of some sorts, which is kind of rolling back and forth.
So you join me, eh?
You don't see a man around you, and the cart kind of pulls to a stop. And you're looking around, and the sky is dark. And you can see that you're kind of in a forested area. There are trees on either side of the roads, but the trees are hollow and barren and scraggly. And you notice something as you hold a hand up, that everything is in black and white. And the driver steps down from his carriage, and he walks around, and you can see that you're actually being pulled by horse. And he pulls down the back, and he looks up to the floor, and he says, "All right, Dracula's castle is just up this way, but it's as far as I'm going to take you. Get off."
Okay, all right.
And wait, as you step down, you hear...
Effort's with us?
What's that?
Yeah, Effort is with us?
Yeah, it's just the four of you in the back. But you hear a ringing coming from Effort. And Effort, you have a buzzing coming from your badge. And you've had this many times, and you look at it, and a text appears across it. And it says...
Oh, fuck.
"Effort, you have failed in your mission to retrieve cracks. We are sending in a new operative. Report back to the estate for debriefing."
Sorry, gentlemen. This is where I leave you. Good luck.
And with that, you see Effort stand up. You see energy coursing through him. And he disappears the same way you saw that you felt when you disappeared from the witch's house back in the woods. The gentleman at the bottom was like scuffing the shoe as he looks up and he says, "Now the four of you..." Oh. Oh, where'd your friend go?
There's only three of us.
Oh, fair enough. Well, like I said, Dracula's castle's up there. You look to speak with him. I don't know why you would, but I'm sure he'll help you fill out those papers that you need. But get off. The rest is your way.
Thank you for your service, sir, ma'am.
And he lets you down, he locks back up, and he says... "But I don't know why you're after him, that gentleman I took up here a few hours ago. But for whatever reason, that's where he is." And he gets back in the carriage, starts turning it around. He says, "But I wouldn't stay the night there if I were you." And with that, he starts riding off.
"Why not? Why not?"
And he says something that you can't quite hear. "Because of the..." And you're standing at the bottom of a long driveway up a cliffside to a massive castle which stands in the hills, and everything's in black and white. And a flash of lightning echoes through the landscape as the rain starts down. And each of you are wearing like coats and stuff from the 1600s, very old, and you feel a little grubbier, and your beards are a little longer. And you look up at the castle, and you see in the soft mud footprints. Fresh footprints within the last hour leading up towards the castle. And we are going to leave it there. Thank you all for being here with us this Wednesday night. We had such a fun time. I'm so glad that you guys in the got that everything can be made fun of and satirized, even the Nazis. You guys had some freaking hilarious, hilarious pictures. The freaking dog. That's so good. So thank you so much for being with us. We had a blast. Thank you to Alex for being with us.
Because
he wanted to get in on a little bit of the strange action, and who knows, maybe we'll see him again, and maybe we'll see a little bit of someone else, another friend of the Invictus stream. So thank you guys so much. Remember to check out the Discord app. It is in the description of the Facebook page. You can check it out there. And we're on there during the week. Oh, there he is, Alex.
Yes.
Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you.
Effort Bellwater, you did a fantastic job leading these guys or helping these guys, I suppose. Maybe just confusing them more for having
maybe. Them. I don't know. I try, but it's always fun playing with you guys. Good. I always enjoy it.
Well, and we always enjoy having you. So thank you guys all for being here. Have a wonderful night, and we'll see you next Wednesday. And as Chris always likes to say,
we'll see you around the table.
We will see you around the table. Have a good night.